Afternoon, everyone. And the first item of business this afternoon is a debate on motion number 14702 in the name of Jamie Hepburn on the Carers Scotland Bill. I invite members who wish to speak in this debate to please press the request to speak buttons now, and I call on Minister Jamie Hepburn to speak to and move the motion. Minister, 14 minutes or thereby.
Thank you very much, President Officer, and I'm very delighted to open this debate on the Carers Scotland Bill and a motion that the Parliament agrees to the general principles of the bill. Can I at the outset thank the Delegated Powers and Law Reform Committee, the Finance Committee and, of course, in particular, the Health and Sport Committee for their work to inform Parliament of their consideration of the bill. I was very pleased to see from the Health and Sport Committee's Stage 1 report the committee supports the general principles of the bill. I'll try and respond today to some of the issues raised by the committee in its Stage 1 report. Can I also thank COSLA, the National Carers Organisations and, crucially, carers themselves and their representative groups for their constructive engagement with the government and for their considerable input to the bill to date. I've tried to listen carefully to all the views expressed, and they've certainly helped me consider how the bill can be improved further or how we can take forward issues outside of the bill itself. I will outline in this speech some of the government amendments I intend to bring forward at Stage 2. If, as I hope it will, Parliament sees fit to agree to the principles of the bill this evening. Several of these amendments are made as a direct result of suggestions and proposals made by particular groups and that have been highlighted by the committee. I hope carers will be able to hear their voices loud and clear throughout the bill's provisions and indeed throughout the passage of the bill through this Parliament. Presiding Officer, there are over 750,000 unpaid carers across Scotland. They do an outstanding job at caring for their loved ones, friends, neighbours, whoever it may be that they provide care for. It is right that we do what we can to better support Scotland's carers. The purpose of the Carers Scotland Bill is that adults and young carers should be better supported on a more consistent basis so they can continue to care, if they so wish, in good health and to have a life alongside caring. The bill aims to do this by extending and enhancing rights for carers in law. Within the wider context of the programme for government, the bill forms a key part of the government's ambition to tackle inequality, promote fairness and encourage participation. Scotland has a growing population of older people successfully living longer, sometimes doing so with a range of complex and multiple physical and mental health care needs. There are also more children with complex health needs or disabilities. 47% of carers in the most deprived areas care for 35 hours a week or more. This is almost double the level in the least deprived areas. We know from research that whilst providing shorter periods of care can be positive for a person's mental well-being, those providing longer hours of care report a negative effect. We need to support Scotland's carers so that they, in turn, can support the many people with illnesses and disabilities or who are frail. We especially need to support those who experience considerable disadvantage. Therefore, our wider work to tackle health inequalities within the even wider context of tackling economic disadvantage is, of course, crucial. The bill is also set in the context of other legislation that will complement the Public Bodies Joint Working Scotland Act 2014 and its provisions enabling the integration of health and social care. I will also work in conjunction with the Social Care Self-Directed Support Scotland Act 2013 and the Children and Young People Scotland Act 2014. Of equal importance is a continued emphasis on supporting carers in ways which cannot be included in the bill, so we will continue to progress, for example, a carer positive to recognise employers who actively support carers in the workforce. I want to turn now, Presiding Officer, to the bill's provisions and the comments of the Health and Sport Committee in their Stage 1 report. The bill introduces a wider definition of carer than exists now. We are removing the requirement that a carer be someone who provides care on a regular and substantive basis. We are also removing the requirement that the cared for person must be a person for whom they, that is the local authority, must or may provide or secure the provision of community care services. All carers can ask for or as well as be offered an adult carer a support plan or young carer statement under the bill's provisions. This means that carers have a right to an assessment of their needs. I want more carers to come forward and to have an adult carer support plan or young carer statement, as these are the gateway to support. Too few carers have an assessment now, and so they are not getting the support they need. The Health and Sport Committee has asked for clarification on how this additional demand will be managed. I want to reassure the committee and stakeholders for whom this is a concern that an adult carer support plan or young carer statement must be proportionate to the needs to be met and should reflect the carer's wishes, preferences and aspirations. It can be what might be described light touch, where that is consistent with those needs, preferences and aspirations. The critical thing is that each individual carer should get a support plan that matches their assessed needs, and additional resources for local authorities will accompany the bill. The Adult Carer Support Plan and the Young Carer Statement will set out the carer's identified personal outcomes and identified needs, and will record the support to be provided to meet those needs. It will also contain information about the adult carer's personal circumstances at the time of the preparation of the plan. This will include the nature and extent of the care provided, the impact of caring on the carer's wellbeing and day-to-day life, and importantly, information about the extent to which the carer is willing and able to provide care. Many carers have said that knowing that the person they care for is supported when they are unexpectedly available, it brings peace of mind. Enable Scotland has very effectively communicated the impact that this can have on carers. The Health and Sport Committee also commented this in its Stage 1 report. I also recognise that this is an issue of importance to carers. Therefore, as the First Minister set out to the Carers' Parliament, I intend to bring forward a Government Amendment at Stage 2 so that the Adult Carer Support Plan and Young Carer Statement will also contain information about emergency planning. I'm pleased that we've been able to position young carers so firmly within the bill. I, along with other members, attended the Young Carers Festival earlier this year. None of us in attendance could fail to have been moved by listening to the experiences of those young carers who were there. The ambition for young carers that they should have a childhood as similar as possible to their non-carer peers. The bill introduces the Young Carer Statement in direct response to feedback from young carers and their representative organisations to recognise the specific needs of young carers. And to further this ambition, the Young Carer Statement must contain information about the extent to which the care provided by the young carer is appropriate. The bill contains provisions which require local authorities to set local eligibility criteria. These eligibility criteria will allow the local authority to determine whether it is required to provide support to carers. There are also powers so that Scottish ministers can specify in regulations matters that the local authority must have regard to when setting their local eligibility criteria. Of course.
Joanne Lamont.
I think certainly young carers, one of the things struck by is the different levels of support in different places. I wonder why you've fallen in favour of having local eligibility criteria rather than establishing a baseline that could be expected right across Scotland, which then local authorities could tailor to particular needs after that.
Minister.
Well, I suppose it's, and I was just about to come on to say, I recognise there has been debate about this particular issue. I think we need to, of course, recognise that local authorities are democratically accountable bodies of their own right. I do recognise it is important that we set some direction, and of course we will do that. I've set out that we will have, by regulations, matters that local authorities must have regard to when setting their local eligibility criteria. I know that the Health and Sport Committee has asked us to consider this further, and we have done so, and we will continue to do so, of course. But what I would say is I recognise that the National Carers Organisations have undertaken a range of work on this matter, which I would thank them for, and I can assure them that the work they have undertaken will certainly inform the regulations that we take forward. My clear commitment to them is to continue to work with them to make sure that we get the regulations and guidance right. But of course, the bill is only at stage one, and I'll consider anything that continues to come forward at stage two. Local authorities are also under a duty, presiding officer, to prepare a local carer strategy and must consult with health boards, carers and carers organisations in doing so. As the Health and Sport Committee noted in its stage one report, these provisions will complement those set out in the Public Bodies Joint Working Scotland Act 2014. All local authority and NHS board functions created under this bill which relate to the delivery of services to adult carers will require to be delegated under integration schemes under the Public Bodies Act. All local authority or NHS board functions relating to young carers will be capable of being delegated to the local authority and NHS board so choose. To complement carers bill provisions on care involvement regulations under the Public Bodies Act, provide for carers to be represented in integration joint boards and on integration joint monitoring committees, and to be involved in strategic and locality planning by integration authorities. I believe it is essential that carers' voices are heard locally, and our legislation will help ensure that should happen. Local authorities will be required to establish and maintain an information and advice service. This recognises the role that timely, accurate information about issues such as income maximisation can play in enabling carers to sustain their caring role and have a life alongside caring, which is, of course, one of the fundamental aims of the bill overall. In complying with this duty, it is my intention that local authorities should pay due regard to existing provision, including that provided by the third sector and NHS boards. The Health and Sport Committee has recommended that this intention should be made clearer. I agree. I therefore intend to bring forward a government amendment at stage two to clarify that where sources of information and advice are already available within the local authority area, there is no requirement to create an additional information and advice service, although the requirement will still be there, of course, to maintain such a service. Finally, I wanted to take the opportunity to clarify the position in relation to the waiving of charges and replacement care. This is an important issue for carers. I'm pleased to confirm that carers will not be charged for replacement care meeting their assessed needs. Neither will the care for person be charged for support that meets a carer's eligible needs. The care for person's views will be taken into account decisions and services which are delivered to him or her in order to meet the carer's needs. When the carer's bill commences, local authorities will be required to waive charges for support provided under Section 22 of the Carer's Bill. Minimal amendments to existing regulations on waiving charges will be required to reflect this change. I want now to say a few words about implementation of the bill. The effective implementation of the Carer's Bill will be hugely important, as there is so much in it of benefit to carers. It enshrines within it a number of significant carers' rights. I want to restate my commitment to key stakeholders to work together to ensure that implementation of the bill is firmly grounded in reality. As I set out earlier, Presiding Officer, the feedback and the views that we have had thus far have been hugely important to us. I look forward to continuing to work constructively together to deliver the regulations and guidance under the bill. I want to thank the Parliament once again for the opportunity to set out what I expect this bill to do to achieve for carers. Although I've mentioned some of the issues raised by the Health and Sport Committee in its report, I know there are other issues there, and I'm sure that will be covered over the course of this afternoon's debate. I look forward to continuing to hear the views of the committee as we move forward to stage two. And indeed, I look forward to hearing what other members have to say on this important issue in the open debate today. President Officer, I move that the Parliament agrees the general principles of the Carer Scotland Bill.
Many thanks. I now call on Duncan McNeill to speak on behalf of the Health and Sport Committee. Mr McNeill, you have 10 minutes or thereby, please.
Presiding Officer, the majority of us here in this chamber have been or will at some point in our lives be carers. For some of us, it will be a lifelong commitment. For others, it will be something that we do intentionally for a few months that will change our lives dramatically, and then it will be over. Being a carer, of course, is born out of love and support for those closest to us. It can bring a source of satisfaction, be life-affirming, and deepen relationships. However, it can also be a role which is not only physically demanding, but requires huge emotional strength, and it can also have a detrimental effect on both the individual's physical, mental health, on their friendships, their relationships, and employment. We, therefore, as a committee, welcome and support the general principles of this bill in seeking to provide better support and rights for carers. It is important to ensure that they continue to care in good health and have a life alongside caring. I would like to take this opportunity to put on record my thanks and the committee's thanks to all the witnesses, especially those carers who gave of their precious time to engage with the committee. We were fortunate to meet with carers from far and wide, Shetland, Falkirk, Glasgow, Skye. We also met young carers, many of whom had been caring since their primary school days, and older carers in their 70s and their 80s. These meetings gave us an invaluable insight to their daily lives, as well as their hopes and aspirations for receiving better support. There is much to be welcomed in this bill, including the broadening of the definition of carer and the provision of a universal entitlement to an adult care support plan or young carer's carer statement, as reflected in the Minister's speech. We also welcome the agreement that has been reached between the Scottish Government and COSLA, which will ensure that charges for replacement care will be waived. This follows on, of course, from the Finance Committee's scrutiny of the financial memorandum. We also welcome the further clarification which has been provided by the Government on replacement care costs, the figure of £16 million now being regarded as the maximum estimate. This was something the committee was keen to achieve before today's vote. An area explored in some detail during the scrutiny that we carried out was the eligibility criteria referred to by my colleague in an intervention in and around the eligibility criteria, which would be used to determine which carers are provided support by the local authority, should be set at a local or a national level. And we recognised from a committee and the evidence that we took the concerns on both sides with regards to setting out eligibility criteria. On the one hand, carers wanted criteria to be set out by the Scottish Government on a national basis from the outset, that they believed that this would provide equity, a degree of certainty for carers right across Scotland, and prevent what many described as a postcode lottery. On the other hand, COSLA and the local authorities were concerned that they needed to be able to prioritise support in line with local needs. Our report calls for the Scottish Government to give further consideration, as the Minister mentioned, to whether the balance of eligibility criteria between government and local authorities is appropriate. Now, the Minister had made it clear that he believes at this point that the right balance has been struck. But I take encouragement from his remarks today that that discussion will continue. But if it stayed the way it was, the way the Minister, and there isn't the Minister's stated view, and there isn't any sort of substantial movement there, the focus becomes on the assessment and monitoring of this approach. People need to be assured that the issues that they worry about are indeed being tackled. And we need to be able to ensure that the approach that's taken is delivering what we expect on the ground. But I welcome the commitment from the Minister and his response to the committee's report that he will continue to work with COSLA, local authorities, national carers organisations and carers to share their ideas and views about eligibility criteria and how it's monitored and how it's successed. I look forward to hearing the outcome of those discussions. In relation to other areas in the bill, there are several where the Minister has listened to our evidence, and we welcome that. The commitment to bringing forward changes in the bill at stage two, we look forward to hearing how we will do that and bringing forward changes to the bill at stage two in the light of our findings. Firstly, our recommendation that consideration would be given to prioritising assessments for carers caring for someone at the end of the end of life. Secondly, our recommendation that it should be made clearer that the focus should be on supporting and enhancing existing carer information and advice services, and that any new services should only be established where necessary, as he has referred to in his speech. Thirdly, our recommendation that adult care support plans and young carer statements should include consideration of emergency planning arrangements. And we look forward to assessing the details of the government's amendments in these areas at stage two. I'm also pleased that the Scottish Government is supportive of our recommendation that there should be a greater emphasis in the bill on the role of the National Health Service. However, I asked for further information from the Minister this afternoon on the issue of hospital admissions and discharges. We heard on several occasions, and we know from our own casework, during that concerns from carers and carer organisations that the lack of consultation with carers when a person for whom they are caring is admitted, or more importantly, discharged from hospital. This often, and you know, results in crisis situations, and ultimately leads to unnecessary readmissions in many cases back into hospital. We ask the government to respond to the call to include provisions in the bill that place a duty on health boards to involve carers in hospital admissions and discharge procedures. The government has confirmed that health admissions and discharge protocols will highlight the importance of consulting carers in the process of hospital admissions and discharges. However, the government has also highlighted that local authorities are required to take into account the views of the carer should the community assessment need to be revised. So far as it is reasonable and practicable to do so. This would appear to suggest that there may be instances where there is not a reasonable or practicable to take carers' views into account before the care person is discharged. And the question that arises from that, Minister, and hopefully you'll be able to give us some examples of where he thinks that that approach would be appropriate, that not to consult carers at the point of discharge. There are several provisions in the bill where the Minister has indicated that further detail will be provided by the way of regulations. This includes further clarification on what is considered a short break for carers. Is the Minister able to provide today further detail on this approach to these regulations? Will draft regulations be published, and what will be the consultation process? We must ensure that just because they are not on the face of the bill, that there is scope for the Parliament and those who will be directly affected by these proposals are able to engage and shape those plans. In conclusion, Presiding Officer, we believe that this bill is an important step to delivering an appropriate care and support to carers in 21st century Scotland, and we recommend that the Scottish Parliament support the general principles of the bill. Thank you.
Thank you. I now call on Rhoda Grant. 10 minutes are thereby, please, Ms Grant.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, and can I also add my thanks to those who give evidence to the committee and indeed to the carers' organisations who have been working alongside committee members, both at committee and in other locations, giving us advice and information about the bill and what they believe should be in it. So I'm very much grateful for that. We welcome the bill. The sentiments and general principles are easy to support. Carers need to be recognised for the role they play, looking after family and friends, giving and continuing to give, even when that's at their own detriment. And it's estimated that the value of that in monetary terms is around $10.3 billion per annum, but the value of what they provide in personal terms is absolutely priceless. And they do this because of love and compassion. They don't want to see their loved ones going without support. And in turn, I believe we must support them. Carers are used to warm words and appreciative statements. What they really need is support. And on the face of it, this bill offers that. But it does need to be strengthened to make sure that it delivers real support for carers. Carers' lives are as different as the individuals themselves. Therefore, their needs will always be different. They cope in circumstances that are often difficult to comprehend. The bill seeks to support carers in their role. Adult carers need to be able to have a life of their own, the ability to work and decide on the extent of their caring role. Young carers need support to be children, to have a childhood and have that role recognised. The bill talks about removing the caring role from preschool children. Young carers' organisations disagree and believe that young children need to be allowed to care, but only to a degree that's appropriate for their age and wishes. And that's a principle I believe that holds true for all carers. They must be given the choice of whether they are carers, and if so, what amount of care they provide. And that's turning current practice on its head. At the moment, carers are expected or often forced to care and do so with very little support. They don't have a choice in the matter. I've heard of constituents who are at breaking point, collapsing from the stress and exhaustion of caring, yet receive no support. They can't attend to their own health needs because no one is there to pick up that caring role. I've also heard of carers who suffer violence because their loved one no longer knows who they are and reacts badly to them. Yet there's no protection for them, and they're told they must continue to care because there is nowhere that can house a violent person to be cared for. And we hear from young carers who have to choose between education and their caring responsibility. Every child needs a childhood, and every child has a right to education, and it shouldn't be compromised by their caring role. Their caring role must be replaced to allow them to access that without the threat of taking them into care. Families need support, not fear. Can I turn to the finance supporting the bill, or possibly not supporting the bill? Both COSLA and carers' organisations are concerned that the financial memorandum is not realistic about the cost of providing support to carers. One carer told me about the cost of providing replacement care to allow her a break would run to thousands of pounds if that was provided for a week, and the financial memorandum doesn't reflect those costs. I welcome that the government has said that there will be finance to replace care, but their costings need to be realistic. They've committed £16 million, but it's not clear if this is from the funding already allocated to the bill or is this new money. There are other aspects of the bill that are also unrealistically costed. The cost of carrying out an assessment itself runs to many hundreds of pounds, something that the financial memorandum doesn't reflect. Neither does the bill take account of the burden on social workers who are already overworked in completing those assessments. I wonder if other organisations or professionals could carry out the care assessments. Could this be a new role for carer centres, which would relieve the pressure of social workers? Presiding officer, I want to turn to the changes that I believe would strengthen the bill. Eligibility criteria is something that has been mentioned by a number of people, and both COSLA and carers organisations are really concerned about this. Councils are under huge financial pressure, taking on more of the burden for a smaller share of the finance. They're concerned that the bill is yet another unfunded demand. They do understand the needs of carers and they empathise. However, that they worry that the services for carers will mean fewer services for the cared for person if this is not properly funded. And were this to happen, the burden would fall back on carers and we would enter a vicious circle. They don't want nationally set criteria for support to carers because they're afraid that this would be unaffordable for them. Therefore, carers are concerned that there will be a postcode lottery with regard to support for carers if the criteria is set locally. The Minister said carers organisations have been looking at this and they've come up with a possible solution to the problem. The ability to set the setting of national standards to prioritise the needs of carers that are unable to continue their caring role without support. For those who are on the verge of having to give up the role or indeed maybe having to choose between employment and caring and those looking after someone at the end of their lives. They suggest that those people should be eligible for support through national criteria. The terms of the support must be person-centred but can be locally decided while delivering the outcome that allows the carer to continue to care. They suggest that support for carers more widely could be set using local criteria, but this would ensure that the most vulnerable needs were prioritised. And this is something that has also been backed by Unison, or suggestions similar to this have been made by Unison. It's especially important in the early stages of delivery of the outcome of this bill, because even government admit that only a small percentage of carers will have their needs met in the early days of the bill, so it's important to make sure that those are the ones most in need. The bill provides for short breaks but lacks a definition of what a short break will be. Will it be an hour to nip to the shops? Will it be an afternoon to meet friends? Will it be a week away to go on holiday? None of it's clear in the bill. What's clear is that carers are the only people in our society that are expected to work unsupported 24/7. A short break needs to be a break from caring. However, it should not be seen as the only support a carer receives to live their lives. I have a number of constituents who have raised this as a concern to me. One was told when she was going into a hospital that she would receive respite care to allow her to get into hospital. Despite being told on discharge from hospital that she should do nothing strenuous for a number of months, her adult daughter was returned to her immediately without any additional support. Her daughter had mobility problems and needs to be lifted as part of her care. And my constituent was told that she had used up her annual allocation of respite and basically to get on with it. Another one being offered a hospital appointment for an operation, organised replacement care herself. That involved a family member travelling from abroad and booking into a respite care bed. All that had been organised only for her own operation to be cancelled at short notice without the ability to change any of the care that she had put in place to replace her own contribution. Can I turn to young carers? And the bill specifically entitles them to a young carer statement, but it's unclear what this statement will provide. As a minimum, it must assess support to ensure the young person has a childhood and is fully engaged in education. The Scottish Youth Parliament's report, A Costly Youth, highlights the impact that caring has on education. Young carers are concerned that this statement will be placed with their child's plan if they have one, or passed to their named person. If the statement is carried out correctly, it will have details about the support the young carer needs, and it also may give details about their home circumstances. And they're not always happy that their head teacher, the default named person, would have access to this. And it will obviously vary depending on the child's relationship with their head teacher and indeed the support they receive from the head teacher. But I believe the Minister needs to look at this again, because I fear that the lack of confidentiality could mean that young carers avoid having a statement and indeed asking for support. It's really important the school knows that they're a young carer to provide educational support, but it should be up to the young person the level of information that is provided to the school regarding their home circumstances. I think the bill also needs to look at accountability and enforcement. A carer's life is challenging enough without having to fight for the support they're entitled to. And we need to acknowledge that things don't always work well. Carers need a simple, straightforward appeals process. The current system is too complicated and takes too long to work for. A carer simply doesn't have the time to navigate through a complicated process, especially if they're looking after someone who is terminally ill. An appeal system that's accessible and simple will benefit carers and allow them to access the support they need. Both the assessment and delivery of support must be subject to appeal, and I would ask that be included in the bill. Presiding Officer, I'm noticing that I'm possibly running out of time.
You can have a little more time if you want.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. The Minister mentioned emergency planning, and I welcome his commitment to amend the bill at stage two to allow for emergency planning. I think something that also has to be included in this is transitions and transition planning, because we see many elderly carers looking after their offspring. They know that their offspring are much more likely to outlive them and worry about what is going to happen to them when they're no longer around. So I think emergency plans are essential, especially in those situations with elderly carers. But I think the assessment needs to look at transition planning as well, so that people have comfort. We need security for advice and information services. And again, I welcome the Minister's commitment to an amendment at stage two. But I think it should be a little bit more secure, rather than no requirement on local authorities to establish services, possibly a commitment that they should support services, because carers' information services are independent of local government. And when much of this support is coming through local government, I think it is important to have an independent voice supporting them. We need equality statements as part of the carers' plans from local authorities. We need a Bill of Rights for carers so that they know what they are entitled to. But, Presiding Officer, in conclusion, we welcome the Bill and hope the Scottish Government will listen to our concerns and work with us to improve it, because if we do that as a Parliament, we can go much further than warm words and actually show carers how much we value what they do.
Many thanks. I'll now call on Dr. Nanette Milne. Dr. Milne, you have 6 minutes or thereby, please.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. I'm very pleased to see this bill making its way through the parliamentary process, and whilst it will require a number of amendments as it goes forward, Scottish Conservatives will be supporting it at stage one. I echo the thanks already expressed to the many witnesses who have given evidence to the Health and Sport Committee, many of them carers themselves, for letting us know where they support the bill's provisions and where they have concerns. The care provided by the many thousands of adult and young carers today is valued at a massive £10.3 billion per year. And whilst there are already various strategies and pieces of legislation in place to help improve carer identification and support, the bill seeks to achieve better and more consistent support for all of Scotland's carers by enshrining their rights in law so that they can continue to care, if they so wish, in good health and able to have a life besides caring. And in the case of young carers, to have a childhood similar to their non-carer peers. The aims of the bill are laudable, and if they're achieved, should make a significant improvement to the lives of the carers who make such a valuable contribution to our society. Having said that, the Health and Sport Committee did hear serious reservations about parts of the bill from the witnesses who gave written and oral evidence, and I note the Minister's response to them and his welcome decision to introduce a number of amendments as the bill proceeds through Parliament. I'll touch on just a few of these concerns during the remainder of my speech. The broadening of the definition of carer and the entitlement to an adult carer support plan or a young carer statement, which should enable more carers to seek support, is generally welcomed. But this has led to concern, as we've heard, about how local authorities will manage the expected increase in demand for an adult care support plan or young carer statement in accordance with carers' wishes and their level of need. And whilst the ministerial response does give some comfort that there will be additional resource available to support the management of demand, there are still very serious concerns about the adequacy of the funding to be made available. There's no timescale specified in the bill for providing an adult care support plan or young carer statement, and there are cases where these are required urgently, such as when a carer is supporting someone at the end of life. I'm pleased the Minister has taken this on board, and I look forward to his stage two amendments. In this context, Marie Curie points out that the bill as drafted will not support carers whose caring role has come to an end following bereavement, for example, and asks the government to consider an amendment to ensure support is available for people as they make the transition away from their caring role. Guidance is also required to give all carers an understanding of the expected timescale for receiving an assessment after one is requested. This should be reasonable and should ensure some consistency across all councils so that all carers receive a support plan as soon as possible. The bill would place an explicit duty on councils to provide support to carers who meet eligibility criteria and discretionary powers to support those who don't. These criteria would be set locally, and I think it's fair to say that this proposal was met with very sharply polarised response from witnesses, with carers very strongly in favour of nationally set criteria to ensure equity across Scotland, and council representatives wanting them set locally. Although the government is satisfied that these proposals are appropriate, and the minister has pledged to work with all stakeholder groups to share ideas and opinions about eligibility criteria, I've no doubt this is an issue we'll hear a lot more about at stage two. Of great importance to carers is the availability of an information and advice service which is local, independent and expert. Such services are already provided within the third sector, and there's strong feeling that the focus should be on funding and supporting them and only setting up new services where necessary. So I look forward to the government's promised stage two amendments to clarify that where such a service is already available locally, there is no reason to duplicate it, although the local authority will be required to ensure that it's maintained. The bill would move the duty to prepare a local carer strategy from health boards to councils, and many of our witnesses felt there should be a greater role for the NHS in identifying carers and signposting them to services and support, particularly, as we know, in light of the ongoing integration of health and social care. So again, I look forward to seeing the government's promised stage two amendments to give effect to this. Planning officer, there's also a call for the bill to include a duty on health boards to involve carers in hospital admission and discharge procedures, because of very valid concerns that a crisis situation can develop if, before discharge, hospital staff do not identify carers and establish that they are willing and able to provide the necessary care. And I hope this is something that the government will consider. There are particular issues with young carers who are less likely to identify themselves as carers and who, depending on their age, may not even realise that they are carers. There's a general welcome for young carer statements, but as Rhoda Grant has said, there's a lack of clarity as to how these will link into children's plans, and there are some concerns about information in them being shared with a young carer's named person, and I think the young carer should have control over where that information goes. Presiding officer, there are several other issues which I don't have the time to deal with in detail, such as emergency planning. But I simply cannot conclude without reiterating the many concerns expressed about the estimated costs of implementing the legislation and the Finance Committee's serious concern about how, with current proposals, charges can be waived for services which support carers, including the replacement care, which is often required to enable carers to take the short breaks, which are so essential if they're to be able to continue with their caring role without detriment to their well-being. Presiding officer, these financial issues simply must be resolved if the bill is to be effective. So as I said at the outset, we will be supporting the bill, the general principles of this very important bill, but there's clearly still some way to go to ensure that it becomes the effective piece of legislation which is envisaged by the government in its policy memorandum. Thank you.
Thank you. And we now move to the open debate. 6-minute speeches or thereby. I call on Graham Day to be followed by Joanne Lamont. We have a very modest amount of time available, so 6 minutes or thereby.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. There are, in relation to this bill, I think, two things which unite the Chamber. Firstly, the fact that we welcome its intent. Secondly, a shared desire to ensure that when it's finished with, it delivers as much as is feasibly and practically possible to improve the lives of carers. Measures which lead to better identification of carers and their needs and the placing of a duty on local authorities to support carers in a variety of ways are as welcome as they are needed. In a wider sense, the reduced budget available to this Parliament and in turn local authorities does restrict their ability to go as far as we might want in giving carers the kind of deal they deserve. But this Government's commitment to increasing the carers' allowance and its successfully pushing the UK Government to bring forward amendments to the Scotland Bill to provide autonomy over defining carers' allowance eligibility, coupled with this bill, is, I think, further evidence of the direction of travel the SNP is committed to as far as carers are concerned. And I acknowledge there are many MSPs and other parties who share the desire to create a framework which better recognises and supports the work of carers. I very much commend the Stage 1 report produced by the Health and Sport Committee, and I say that not in any way because I'm currently a substitute member of the committee, because I played no part in the scrutiny process, but it is an excellent piece of work. I also welcome the Scottish Government's response to it. We started out on the right track with this bill. The committee and the minister, in his response to the report and in his remarks today, have put fresh impetus into that journey. Although, of course, there remain areas of the bill where I think there is scope for further improvement. The government's intention to bring forward amendments to ensure that adult carer support plans and young carer statements will contain information about emergency planning is, again, as welcome as it is necessary. Anyone with the slightest knowledge of carers recognises that concern. What would happen if I had to go away or go into hospital myself and the anxiety it causes? The planned Stage 2 amendments regarding settling timescales for the preparation of adult carer support plans and young carer statements where the care for the person is terminally ill similarly is a step in the right direction. But the whole point of this scrutiny process, which today forms part of, is to consider how we might further improve the bill. And there are a number of opportunities in that regard, I feel. Waiting times for adult carer support plans and young carer statements and the duty relating to hospital discharge are two of these. I am concerned that there is no national time limit to be set on the production of carers' assessments. As we know already, there can be wide variations in performance in this area and, frankly, ridiculous delays stretching not just into months but into years. I think we need to send a message through the bill process that we want to see greater consistency reflecting best practiced examples. I'm not sure that intended timescales being included in each local carer strategy will on its own necessarily deliver that. The issue of hospital admission and discharge is well dealt with in paragraphs 106 to 108 in the Stage 1 report. I note what the Minister says in his written response about the existing bill provisions supporting the involvement in carers in hospital admission and discharge procedures, and that he says the accompanying guidance will highlight the importance of involving carers in that process. But twice within that report, the Minister uses the phrase where it is reasonable and practicable to do so. And whilst I do not doubt the Minister's intention in this area, I do wonder, I think as Duncan McNeill has, if we don't need to strengthen this part of the bill. Who will determine when the circumstances are such that it's reasonable and practicable to take the views of the carer into account? Harassed ward staff, the busy social work team member. I share the concerns expressed by carer organisations that the reality may differ from what is intended, and I would hope this could be considered again. Difficult though nailing it down might actually be. The Minister has agreed to bring forward amendments to put beyond doubt the role of the NHS in preparing local carer strategies and identifying carers. I just wonder whether we might be able to tighten things up somehow in this area also. In a similar vein, but without necessarily seeking an amendment, I'd also note the committee's comments on the role of GP practices in identifying and supporting carers. I appreciate entirely that GP practices are under considerable pressure and welcome the fact carer identification will be covered in the guidance. But I just make the point that if, as I've found in my own constituency, some GP practices won't even display posters directing patients to carer support services, there may be work to be done in ensuring they go beyond even that basic action. Can I also, like Nanette Milne, touch upon an important issue raised by Marie Curie regarding supporting the needs of those carers whose caring role has come to an end? As they say, many carers will need support after they have finished caring. I know from my work locally with the Carer Centre on Arbroath and hosting visits to Parliament by carers from all over Angus that the support network and camaraderie on offer, never mind the advice and practical assistance provided by staff from these organisations, is vital in helping people cope with their caring responsibilities. There's also surely a need for access to such when those responsibilities end and they seek to move on in their lives. The Angus Carers Centre in my constituency extends access to their services for 2 years after the person's caring responsibilities have come to an end. I'd be interested, and I'm sure the Minister would be interested as well, as to whether that is typical across Scotland, because if it isn't, then perhaps we need to explore how we can provide support to former carers in this position. Presiding Officer, I hope the Minister, as I am sure he will, takes my contribution in the spirit that's intended. As I said earlier, the bill as drafted provided an excellent starting point. The Stage 1 report of the Health and Sport Committee, along with the response to it of the Minister, offers to move that along. With the will to take that further, which I'm sure exists, I think we can end up with a piece of legislation which has the potential to really make the kind of tangible difference to the lives of carers that we would all of us want. Thank you.
Thanks very much. Now call on Joanne Lamont, to be followed by Linda Fabiani.
Thank you very much, Deputy Presiding Officer. We know that there is significant support for carers across this chamber, and indeed that some of us will have been carers in our lives or perhaps at some point in the future. And we'll certainly have met people across our communities who undertake the most immense burden in difficult times, and they have our admiration. Carers through love and occasionally, as I have been told, by accident have been caught up in a caring role, go far beyond what most can imagine, disrupting their own lives to give people the care they need. And it's no doubt since the establishment of this Parliament that carers' voices have been heard. They've been at the heart of many of our debates, and the campaigning caring organisation, the carers themselves, should be congratulated for how effective they have been. But there is a challenge for this legislation, and we do need to ask, are we not just hearing but listening to what carers are telling us? We will be damned if we settle for rhetoric and not actually delivering on the aspirations of carers themselves. There needs to be a will to make a real difference. If warm words put food on the table, carers in particular would be feeding on a banquet every night. And that is a challenge, I think, for all of us. I'm proud of the work that Labour did when in power, in particular the establishment of carer centres, understanding the need for support that was flexible, that reached out to people and supported people when they themselves were in circumstances where they found it difficult to get through process. And I want particularly to pay tribute to Glasgow South West Carer Centre in my own constituency, who not only provide practical support to carers, to young carers, but also actually support carers who no longer have a caring role and are very much offering friendships to people as they come to terms with bereavement. And they've highlighted a number of specific points, as they often do with me when I meet with them, which I think would be useful for me to raise with the Minister. And I want to raise some points about from the cross-party group and carers as well. And then I'd like, if I've got time, to make a number of broader observations about the bill. There is a frustration expressed by many carers that some of the care support they need is not big stuff. It's maybe time to go to the hairdresser, it's maybe time to go to the library, it's maybe time to go to church or spend a little time with your friends. And there is a frustration that often access even to a little bit of respite or support can involve a very long and complicated process, which in some cases will be more expensive to fund than the actual cost of the support itself. An example of a woman who cares for her husband wanted to go to her granddaughter's wedding. It took more than 9 months to establish whether she was going to be able to get that time off, and even then she lacked the confidence in the care that was going to be offered to her husband to allow her to go. Surely we can find a way, Minister, of finding a process, a fund that could be established that with speedy access for small amounts of money, which would make a huge difference to people in their ordinary lives, helping them to sustain their caring role. Also, it's highlighted to me problems with the carers' information monies, and I understand the plan to take that from the health boards and give it to local authorities. But there is a concern that the monies currently have, on some occasions, been handed back unspent and therefore not been given the opportunities to support carers. So what mechanism has the Minister considered with the plan change to local authorities to ensure that the funding gets as close to carers as possible, so it doesn't get lost in process, but it's actually directed towards those who need it most? And in relation to young carers, there are very practical issues that need to be addressed, including attendance conditions and educational maintenance allowances in schools, and what work has been done to ensure that colleges and universities understand the particular barriers that young people face if they are carers. They need the liberation and support of education almost more than most young people do, and we should be sure that we are talking to those authorities about that. So I think, like others, I support, accept the support for the bill at this stage, but it cannot in itself be enough. We need to be honest about the tough context in which carers are now working. And I've been struck by the dilemma that emerges in the bill with the proposal to open up the identification of carers and assessment of their needs. I understand the rationale of early identification, but we must reflect on the fear expressed that such a broadening may dilute the support available to carers who are already in need. In truth, a right which is unenforceable is unacceptable. We need not just to declare the right, but will the means to deliver. And that's a practical challenge to the government and to the minister. It's not good enough for us here to create a right and then sit back and denounce local authorities when they fail to deliver upon it. I also recognise the emphasis about the identification of young carers, and that can be a challenge. In my last teaching post, working to support young people to stay in mainstream education, I met many young people who were carers, and some of them entirely inappropriately carers. I know that understanding a young person's situation, where they may be reluctant even to talk about the reality of their family life, is more likely where there's a strong guidance team, a strong attendance officer team, behaviour support, learning support, classroom assistance. These are the people that have the intelligence, the understanding to reach out and see that perhaps this young person is struggling because of what's happening in their home.
Finlay.
One of the worst moments I had in teaching myself was when a young girl came into my class each day in the morning, late, and I chastised her for being late every morning because no one had provided me with the information to tell me that she was a carer. It was absolutely awful, and that's where the system breaks down.
I think I'll make two brief points. We need to have more confidence in giving our teachers information that they'll treat it professionally, and definitely, if they don't treat it appropriately, deal with them in the way, because they've behaved in an inappropriate way. But the point I make is the intelligence within schools is very often garnered by those who are not simply teachers. And at this very moment, our schools are being stripped of these very supports because of the pressures of their budgets. We need to see carers in the context of a real world, which is increasingly stressful. If they're working, their tax credits may now be getting removed, and increased flexibility being demanded of them by their employer zero-hours contracts, being available for longer, which means that they are unable to guarantee they can care for their loved one. People forced out of work because of a lack of proper support. And I want to raise, and very briefly, the particular problem of kinship carers in my city. I'm sure the Minister is aware that 32% of all children supported in kinship care situations are in Glasgow. And I simply ask him to look again at the funding that is needed to match our aspiration that kinship carers should have parity with foster carers. And please give me a guarantee that we do not sit and all blame each other for that situation. We need to work together to get a solution, for, particularly for kinship carers. We understand the central role of local authorities in offering support for carers. And therefore, it is essential, whether it's in health or in education or in social work, wherever it might be, that we are honest about how we are going to ensure that local authorities are properly supported. Across this chamber, we have a responsibility. We are saying that local authorities must deliver good quality care. We need to have a fundamental look at how much we regard local authorities and how we fund it. And that would be, for me, a key commitment to any bill that says it wants to give increased support to carers.
Thanks so much. Now call on Linda Fabiani to be followed by Jim Hume.
Thank you much, Presiding Officer. I do welcome the Carers Scotland Bill, of course, and the fact that after so many years of everyone in this Parliament coming together to try and get the best rights for carers, we're now looking at a bill which will enshrine carers' rights in law for the first time in Scotland. But of course, what many people have said is absolutely right. Indeed, the Minister himself said it. Implementation is hugely, hugely important. And, you know, that covers implementation right at the start, but also the ongoing, the monitoring, the funding, the guidance, the regulations, the mix between guidance and legislation. And I hope that the Minister is having ongoing discussions with COSLA and, of course, with local authorities as to how this can best be implemented and monitored. Stage one in any debate is a really good opportunity to raise particular issues, perhaps missed areas for improvement and identification of potential unintended consequences that sometimes come up. The report of the Health Committee highlighted some of this, and the commitment already by the government to introduce amendments at stage two is welcome, such as that for emergency planning. I want to raise two particular kinds of carers today to make sure that the particular circumstances have been well considered fully through the consultation process and the drawing up of this bill for introduction. The first one is carers of adults with learning difficulties. This has been raised many times by myself and others in the chamber over the years, and there are particularly active elderly carers in my own constituency of East Kilbride who have helped very much to force improvements in some of this. Where you have carers who are parents of their own children who are now adults and who have learning difficulties, it puts into stark relief the needs of some of the things we are talking about here. Support plans are absolutely necessary. And there is an issue about there not being any statutory timing put on the introduction of these support plans. I think that's hugely important when you're looking at particular categories of carers, and this is one. And that leads on to emergency plans. We've talked for many years of the good practice of having crisis plans, emergency plans, but the theory doesn't always translate into practice, and I have seen examples of that. And the stress on someone who is perhaps 80 or above, as I do know, the absolute terror of something happening to them and their child, regardless of age, their child with vulnerabilities, coming home and mum and or dad not being there anymore, and there not being a proper plan in place, is a huge stress for these carers to deal with. So I would like to see support plans and emergency plans for this particular category of carer being given absolute priority. I think it's so very, very important. Also, I think it was Duncan McNeill that raised it on behalf. Yes, of course.
Richard Simpson.
The social care integration, it is absolutely vital that these emergency plans are actually on the GP record, because when the individual is admitted, the adult, the parent, if the GP knows that there's an emergency care plan they can call on, it actually makes life a lot easier for absolutely everybody.
Linda Fabiani.
Yes, I absolutely do agree with that and was going to come on to that. It's about the joined up way of looking at health and social care. And I noticed that Inclusion Scotland also had a concern that as carer support plans will be statutory, they'll take precedence over social care packages, which are discretionary. So I think we've got to make sure that we really do have a joined-up system to the benefit of the people who need it. So very, very important. We started well with the integration of health and social care. Here's another way that we can truly look at preventative measures of real stress and real crisis. The other group of carers I'd like to bring up is one that has I've a fairly recent knowledge of. I hadn't really thought it through before, but I've been given it a lot of thought for circumstances within the constituency. And that is about the families of those who end up suffering from early onset dementia. We talk, obviously we have to talk lots about dealing well with people with dementia generally, but there's very particular issues that come when someone has early onset dementia. For example, this could be someone 40s, even 30s, 40s, 50s, so their partner's still working, has a career. And again, it's about that interaction between the social care, the home care package, and the part-time caring responsibilities which the partner or indeed the adult children in the house may well have. We have to try and get that right. We shouldn't be assuming that someone will give up work to be a full-time carer, because that, in fact, may not well be in the best interests of the person who requires the care. As a constituent said to me, I want to be able to take her on holiday, I want to be able to take her out and about, I want to be able to afford in older age through my pension to do these things because she loves it, it gives her a great sense of well-being. That is absolutely hugely important. And again, we have to look at the needs of the person and the needs of the carer and take full account of what is best for the well-being of that entire family unit. So I think what I'm calling for here is a consistency in how we deal with such things, a recognition that not every case is textbook and can have a box ticked and then say we've dealt with it. I have another constituent who has caring duties both for a parent with dementia and a child with very special needs. The ongoing difficulty is that you have two branches of the same social work department in the council who don't communicate, and therefore this woman never gets a day off. There surely must be better ways of doing things. We can surely do that through the support plan, but only if we know that support plans will timelessly be put in place. Thank you very much, Presiding Officer.
Thank you very much. I call on Jim Hume to be followed by Sandra White. 6 minutes or thereby, please.
Thank you very much, Deputy Presiding Officer. I believe this bill has the potential, of course, to improve the lives of thousands of people. This is an opportunity to change the way carers are seen and supported, and also, of course, make their lives easier through that, also the lives of the people they care for as well. We've been discussing the changing demographics in Scotland in the Chamber. The pensionable age population is projected to grow by 47% in some areas in the next 25 years. This is great news, of course. People are living longer, but we need to make sure that they're living healthier as well. Currently, a large part of the responsibility for elderly people or people who are not fully capable to take care of themselves or people who have mental problems or disabilities, of course, lies with their carers. Both paid and unpaid, nearly 800,000 carers in Scotland provide support to their loved ones with an estimated value of about £10.3 billion. So that's 745,000 adult carers and 44,000 young carers under the age of 18. While it's important for care to be delivered at home and be consistent, I think we need to recognise the negative effects that caring has for people. I'm glad to be supportive of those principles of the bills that put a layer of support and protection to the carers. The Scottish Health Survey analysis of mental wellbeing amongst carers showed that mental wellbeing scores decrease as hours of care increase, with 177,000 people over the age of 16 providing more than 35 hours of care each work. There is a clearly need to act proactively and prevent a decline in their mental wellbeing. I'm looking forward to seeing the successful implementation of the relevant bill provisions for adult carer support plans and the young carer statements. I think it's vital starting point, and we have to, of course, make sure that the mental health of carers is in good condition, of course. Unfortunately, as we know, a timely treatment is not the easiest thing for people to obtain. I've repeatedly called for preventative spending on mental health, and I want to see that such spending and relevant services and treatments are available for anyone who is a carer as well. Similarly, the Carers Coalition warns that the waiting times for an adult carer support plan must be cut down. Timescales must be spelt out and reasonable and seek to fulfil the purpose of supporting carers. Taking through unnecessary paperwork and more waiting times is, I think, the last thing that they need on top of all their responsibilities. Addressing the issue of the young carers statement, it's been mentioned that there needs to be a stronger system for advocacy, redress and appeal, and involvement, more involvement of young carers in the development of those statements. I argue that there's one of the preventative measures that we can take to ensure that young people have a say in their own plans. And I'm supportive of other similar provisions in the bill, such as supported short breaks, replacement care and, of course, right to advocacy, especially for young carers. However, Deputy Presiding Officer, I'm aware that a common thread of concern has been the postcode lottery for some of these services. Health inequalities will not reduce if we compound them with unequal treatment of carers. So I would like to see in the next stage of this bill, should it proceed, and I'm sure it will, that we are taking the right steps to address issues such as local eligibility criteria that might undermine need because of financial restraints in any particular area. But we can ensure that decisions are taken locally. We must, I think, empower carers and councils to take them, but we must also make sure that equality is prescribed in that actual law. Otherwise, we might risk seeing health inequalities only grow further. I think carers belong to a very special group of people which we can't allow to remain in the margins any longer. Their concerns have to be taken at face value, but I do want to point to the fact that the health and social care integration going live next year should and hopefully will act as a gateway for increased involvement. GPs may have a role to play in this. Identifying carers and signposting them to services and support perhaps is the first step. And I believe that this is in fact one of the main concerns of the national carer organisations. And that current strategies, such as the National Carer Strategy, has not perhaps taken that on board yet. Subsequently, involving carers in the NHS processes, such as hospital admissions and discharge, I think is useful. It saves time and money and is better, of course, for the patient involved. There are calls and proposals for further involvement and, in fact, a responsibility on health boards to inform and involve carers in their decisions for hospital admission and discharge. I think it's been proven that carer involvement reduces the need for readmission as they know best what the person they care for needs in their daily lives. So I again stress that this must include both adults and young carers. Deputy Presiding Officer, I just like the majority of individuals and organisations that support the principles of this bill want to see that the details are set up on the outset. We can achieve this by taking into account the views of the numerous organisations representing carers' rights, but also the Carers' Parliament. So I hope to see this bill proceed to stage two, where views on how to strengthen and improve its provisions will, I think, be welcome, and I look forward to being part of that. Thank you.
Thank you so much. Now, Colin Sandra White, to be followed by Jackie Bailey.
Thank you very much. Thank you, Presiding Officer. I'm very pleased to be speaking in this debate on the bill. And although I'm not a member of the committee who took evidence on this bill, I think it is really important, not just to me, but to the many groups and constituents that I represent, that we look to the rights of both adult and young carers. and has already been stated, there are an estimated 745,000 adult carers and 44,000 young carers in Scotland. And I really do think it's incumbent upon us as parliamentarians and the Parliament as well to encourage and empower carers of all ages to exercise their rights. And as I mentioned previously, there is an estimated 745,000 adult carers in Scotland. And it really is those carers that I want to concentrate my contribution on, albeit the contribution I'll make may be a small percentage of those 745,000 carers. They're nonetheless, I think, and most people would think also, extremely important percentage of carers. And Linda Fabiani did raise this issue in one of her constituents and raised it very passionately in her contribution. Presiding officer, as convener of the cross-party group in older people, age and ageing, I am acutely aware of carers over the age of 70 years and over the age of 80 years, as already been stated by Linda Fabiani, who are themselves caring for older people. And some of these older people they're caring for are pensioners also, some who have just older, some who have disabilities, and some who need care. And these older people come along to our cross-party group, and I know Rhoda Grant has been present at the cross-party group also, where they have great difficulty in trying to get care for their older children. And as Linda Fabiani said, it doesn't matter what age they are, they're still their children. And I'll go on to explain in regards to care or break or respite, as we call it, is a very, very difficult thing for an older person to get when they're caring for older people also. And I do recognise that the reshaping care for older people change fund and the carer component, I do recognise the fact that money has been put there and specifically for the carer component of it. And it has made a very big difference with many groups, and I won't mention all the groups and projects which involve carers in shaping of services, development, local strategies, and generally providing a better quality of life for both carers and those that they care for. I know it's been raised previously in other contributions. I think Nanette Milne raised the fact about we really need to look at strategies also. And I would hope that this involvement, which has been so successful throughout Scotland, would continue, and I'm sure it will continue, but I really hope that it would continue with the help of the carers involved that I've already mentioned, once the local authority's duty is placed upon them. And I would ask the Minister, and possibly through amendments, would there be any checks and balances? Perhaps that's the wrong word, I don't know, but would there be any checks and balances put on this involvement by local authorities to ensure that carers are actually involved the way they are already in strategies? It would be interesting to see if this is still continued once the duty is placed on local authorities. So I would like that the Minister, perhaps in his closing remarks, if he could mention that as well. Now, Rhoda Grant mentioned the short breaks, as it's called, and we always called them respite, and I think they're still called respite as well. And I think this is a really, really important issue. Nanette Mill also pointed out this in her contribution and mentioned about the finances of that and the Finance Committee's comments on this. And I do note the Finance Committee's comments, particularly on the care component of respite, which involves COSLA carers and those they care for as well. And I wonder if the Minister has an update on this particular position, along with COSLA, just to see if we can find out exactly what will happen, not just to the carer having the short breaks or the respite, but obviously to the people who are being cared for. I think that's an important component of that also. As I mentioned before, presiding officer, it does take into account carers of all ages, but the 1%, well, the small percentage, it may not be that small, of carers of 80, 82, 84 even, is something which isn't raised that often. And I think it's something that should really be put at the top of the agenda when we're looking at this carers component. And I want to finish off in the conclusion, Presiding Officer. It's not been mentioned very much today. I think it's not been mentioned at all, but I'll mention it. We talked about the Smith Commission and the recommendation that the Scottish Parliament have complete autonomy over carers' allowance eligibility. And I think that's a really important one, particularly when now we see the recent amendment which has been tabled to the Scotland Bill, which I would hope would achieve this, which was put forward by the Scottish Government in the first place. But what I would like to ask, and I don't know if the Minister can find this out, I'm sure we will through the Westminster when it's debated on Monday, I think it is, I would ask that we get complete assurances that elderly carers who are themselves pensioners, who do get benefits and other entitlements, they do not miss out on these entitlements because of the new carers' allowance and the eligibility. I think that's important. Everyone should be entitled to that. And I wouldn't like to see the fact that because you have another benefit where we don't have control over, it may adversely affect the benefits that pensioners who are already caring for their sons and daughters who are pensioners may lose out. So I'll leave you with that thought. And thank you very much, Presiding Officer.
Many thanks. I now call Jackie Bailey to be followed by Bob Doris.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Other members in the Chamber have spent much time on the particular provisions of the Bill and the importance of supporting carers. And I don't want to repeat that because we have had powerful speeches already from Duncan McNeill, Joanne Lamont and others across the Chamber. Rather than do that, I want to spend my time looking at the financial aspects of the Bill, and I do so with a genuine concern that expectations have rightly been raised by the Bill, but there may be insufficient resources to meet those expectations. Now, I have two carers' centres in my constituency, Carers of Western Bartonshire and the Helensburgh and Lomond Carers' Centre. Both do a tremendous job without question. In both cases, the numbers of carers they support is constantly increasing. There are about 10,000 carers who live in Western Bartonshire. Per head of the population, we have the highest numbers in Scotland, according to the latest census. Western Bartonshire also has the highest number of people per head of population with one or more long-term conditions. A high proportion of them will be carers, which result in them managing their own health alongside their caring role. Western Bartonshire carers supported 1,060 individual carers last year. 385 of them were new referrals, and the organisation dealt with something in the order of 4,600 inquiries. So demand is rising. In Helensburgh and Lomond, the number of new carers registered last year was 91. This number has already been exceeded, and we're only just halfway through this year. Overall, they're supporting some 800 carers, and demand here too is rising rapidly. It's great news that both are reaching more carers than ever before. However, funding is becoming increasingly difficult. Year-to-year contracts, uncertainty about future funding sources, the consequent effect this has on staff retention is making it incredibly difficult for the very organisations that deliver for carers, and we need to find more effective ways of supporting them. In Helensburgh and Lomond, funding for the very successful Young Carers Initiative comes to an end in April 2016. They've been unable to secure funding to continue this valuable service, leaving 150 young carers facing a future without that essential support. Now, members will be aware that the Carers Information Strategy funding finishes, as I understand it, in March 2016. The information that carers' centres have received suggests that the funding for the Bill won't kick in until 2017. So it doesn't take a genius to work out that there is a gap. And as far as I'm aware, what's been said about it hasn't been a great deal, but is making people nervous about what happens between 2016 and 2017. Because this represents core support posts for carers funded by the strategy, and the real concern on the ground is that these will be terminated unless there is money available on a transitional basis to bridge the gap. So I wonder whether the Minister could, in his summation, advise the Chamber of what provision will be in place from April 2016 to April 2017 to avoid that unnecessary and disruptive interruption to the service. Now, I understand the guidance accompanying the Bill is likely to say that there will be money for two additional posts. The carers organisations I've spoken to are genuinely concerned that these posts are not in fact additional. We can all agree that the impact of the bill will undoubtedly raise awareness, but then for these carers organisations to cope with that rising demand that I've already described on a standstill staffing assumption is just not tenable. And it's not just a rising demand that they're faced with now, but that they'll be faced with ever more so in the future, but that the carers they're dealing with are requiring more contact and more intense support than before. So whilst the new carers legislation is absolutely welcome, it might be undermined if the support within the community is depleted or vanishes. And I would be grateful for the Minister's comments on this in his closing remarks. Now, the Minister will be aware that the Finance Committee thought there were deficiencies with the financial memorandum and the clarity required for costs were not as we would have wished, and I suspect he shared that as well. Indeed, the Committee suggested at the time bring forward a supplementary financial memorandum between Stage 2 and Stage 3. The Minister agreed at the time, but changed his mind, and he believed that he would bring forward proposals to give effect to the waiving of charges through secondary legislation and put the financial consequences in a policy note. Members will appreciate that this is without precedent. So I very much welcome the further clarity provided by the Minister in his letter to the Finance Committee on the 26th of October that the cost of replacement care will be a maximum of £16 million per year in the first year of the Bill's implementation. That £16 million aims to meet the cost of any additional replacement care that is put in place to meet the assessed needs of carers. But I confess to being confused. Am I right to assume that this is to cover what's already in place, which is welcome, or is this about how we meet new demand? And given his announcement, does he intend to bring forward a supplementary financial memorandum, and does he now not need to bother with the policy note and regulations? Or the financial information in the policy note. Now, the Minister says the £16 million will be accommodated within the overall cost envelope set out in the financial memorandum. Well, carers organisations are very concerned that this leaves very little remaining in the financial envelope for everything else. The national care organisations are concerned that this takes no account of any new demand that might arise from the increased number of adults and young carers receiving an assessment. And if you take year one, the Scottish Government anticipate, according to the financial memorandum, spending £19 million in 2017-18. If £16 million is the cost of replacement care to be found in 17-18, from that amount, it leaves a mere £3 million for everything else. Now, I hope that the Minister will tell me I've got my sums wrong and provide the reassurance that everybody is looking for out there. Because this bill will raise awareness, it will raise expectation, and on the evidence before us, there may not be sufficient resources to turn those good intentions that I know the Minister has into reality. Recognition for the important work of carers across this chamber has been heard this afternoon, but let's back that up with the resources to enable them to do their job.
Many thanks. I now call on Bob Dorris to be followed by Jane Baxter.
Thanks very much, Presiding Officer. There's a lot of good in this bill. So carers' rights will be enshrined in law fully for the first time. We're broadening and widening the definition of a carer and easing what that threshold is for providing a caring role. There will be a more systematic process of assessing carers' needs and providing support for them. We'll be placing a statutory duty in local authorities to involve carers and their representatives in planning and the delivery of support. And there will be, yet again, further progress to expand short breaks and a break in caring for carers. That will happen. The bill will drive progress in supporting both adult and young carers. What we're talking about this afternoon is the extent of that progress and the extent to which we will improve the lives of carers out there. It is surely a good thing additional monies are being provided. The lives of carers will be improved. What we're debating is to the extent to which the lives of carers will be improved. And we should embrace that this afternoon on a cross-party basis in this Parliament. And of course, there's a financial context to the whole thing. I won't be drawn into the yabby politics of yesterday and this morning at First Minister's questions in relation to the financial constraints on this Parliament and other cuts coming down the line. But we can't deal with the financial reality across all sectors of government without looking at the entire funding package to Scotland from the UK. So, of course, this will be tough to deliver and implement and fully fund. But the Scottish Government is committed to doing that, and the lives of carers, they will improve. That is just a fact, because more money is being provided. That is also a fact. In relation to kinship care, which we heard about earlier from Joanne Lamont, I see she's no longer in the chamber at the moment, saying that the needs of kinship carers hadn't been met. I just double-checked my facts there. On the 10th of September, the Scottish Government announced that £10.1 million was being given to councils to raise kinship carer allowances to the same level as foster carers, benefiting 5,200 vulnerable young children, many of them in the constituencies that I represent. So Joanne Lamont was just wrong. I know Jane Baxter's here, who's in a moment, yes, I wrote Jane Baxter's here, who has also championed the cause of kinship carers. And undoubtedly, there's been huge progress since 2007 when the Scottish Government took office, and it's been done on a cross-party basis. Yes?
John McAlpine.
Notwithstanding the comment about cross-party basis, he draws attention to the fact that the government has put this money in place. It's my experience that some Labour councils are not actually taking forward that money and getting it where it's supposed to go, to the kinship carer. Certainly in Dumfries and Galloway that's the case. And I wonder if it's also the case with the Labour Council in Glasgow?
Bob Doris.
I have to say there's been progress made with the Labour Council in Glasgow. They used to give no money to look, kinship carers have looked after children in the city. And it was actually, remember Stephen Purcell, it was my intervention to Stephen Purcell that got a £40 a week allowance for the first time in Glasgow. So yes, there's more to be done in Glasgow, but there has been progress to be made. And given the fact that the local authority may be criticised by myself later in this speech, I think we have to give them credit where they are making progress, I have to say. But I want to look at the details of this bill. And I want to look at the increase of adult carer assessments and young carer support plans that will be generated. And resourcing concerns were there, and I'm glad the Minister's addressed those today. And I'm also glad that the Minister's response to the committee makes clear that local authorities will be able to prioritise how quickly they address some carer assessments and young carer support plans. And I notice we still want more details in relation to the expected timescales around that. And I do notice that the Minister says that because the expected timescales will be published by each local authority, that will drive consistency. And it may drive consistency, but at some point we may have to step to ensure consistency. But I've got an additional suggestion in relation to the drawing up of carer assessments. The Health and Sport Committee is currently involved in a palliative care inquiry. I wonder if the Minister would give consideration every time a carer assessment has been drawn up, if those assessing care will give cognizance to whether there's actually unidentified as yet palliative care taking place by that carer. And if so, if that could drive change in that sector as well. And I think that would be very, very important if we could do that. The committee looked in some detail over eligibility criteria. I actually found there was a lot of confusion by stakeholder groups in relation to eligibility criteria and what would be national and what would be local. And there was a confusion over what the threshold would be to receive care or care support, or what the level of care or care support would be. And it was my understanding, I think the committee's understanding, that we weren't saying that every local authority in the country would provide the same provision of support. But what we were looking for as a committee to make sure those of similar needs all had support provided at a local authority level, but importantly, local authorities the flexibility to prioritise the level of support that was available. So perhaps that's something we have to look at as well. In relation to information advice services, and this is an important point, Presiding Officer, some third sector organisations were worried that that requirement for information advice services may lead to local authorities tendering or contracting out existing contracts and undermining their role. And I'm delighted that the Minister has said that he is quite clear that is not the situation, that will not be the case, and that will be clarified and a Stage 2 amendment. And local authorities do have forum in relation to this. And this is where I say to Joan McAlpine, I'll mention Glasgow City Council, because local authorities have been known to use and abuse Scottish Government legislation, namely self-directed support. I have to say, for very vulnerable adults who have learning disabilities, were forced into a personalisation agenda and services, key services were withdrawn to them, and when they asked why, they were told it's because of the Scottish Government's self-directed support legislation. That was just absolutely wrong. So we have to make sure that there's no unintended consequences to this bill, and that's why it's very, very important the Government brings forward that amendment in relation to information and advice services at stage two. The final thing I would like to say, Presiding Officer, and I know lots of it's important, but this, I promise you, is vitally important. There's much discussion around how we can better support carers in relation to hospital admission and discharge and making sure they're part of that process. But what we don't really talk about enough, I think, is those who come into hospital and there are carers there that have been yet to be identified. An admission to hospital by someone should be a trigger to identify whether there's an unidentified carer and a carer's assessment offered. So I think that is an opportunity that we have within this bill. So this will improve the lot of carers. Together as a parliament, let's get together to improve and enhance this bill and deliver for all of our constituents in the vital job that carers do in my city of Glasgow and right across Scotland.
Thank you very much. I now call Jane Baxter to be followed by Willie Coffey.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. I'm not a member of the Health and Sport Committee, so I haven't been involved in the detailed scrutiny of this bill, but I am very pleased to speak today about what is a very important bill. And this bill's got the potential, if we get it right, to transform the lives of carers and, by association, those they care for across Scotland. Estimates vary, but it's widely accepted that there are almost 800,000 carers in Scotland. According to Carers UK, the economic value of this unpaid care is in excess of £10 billion, but the emotional value of such care is incalculable. Many of us will have witnessed or indeed had our own experiences of the role that carers play. And when it's your friends or family who are affected, of course few would hesitate to help. But the responsibility of caring for a vulnerable person often goes way beyond helping and may be more demanding and stressful and go on for much longer than carers can offer without additional support. The care that is needed and provided is vital and is too often not apparent to others, and as a consequence, the value of that care is not always recognised or valued. Too often, support services do not even know that someone is a carer. People often care for loved ones alone, with little or no external support or engagement with support services. We need to identify carers at the earliest possible stage so they know what support is available to them. It is also common for carers who themselves have additional support needs to not be identified as such. So underpinning how we can change that for the better is the importance of the NHS in preparing carer strategies. The NHS can provide a great deal of support, not just to the person being cared for, but for carers themselves. Far too often, however, they are not aware of the support available to them. In the interest of both the cared for person and the carer, the centrality of the NHS to supporting care and carer needs and carers need to be formally recognised in this legislation. In considering the issue of carers being invisible, I want to say something about young carers. Ever since I was a councillor in Fife, I've supported the campaign to recognise the important role played by those young people. It wasn't something I had much experience of, but Fife Council ran an awareness-raising campaign for staff and councillors. The council knew that although it was likely that there were thousands of young carers in Fife, the reality was that very few of them are known to the services who could help and support them. And whilst, of course, it is the case that young carers have a right to privacy, it's also important that they realise they're not alone, they do have rights, and that there are services and people who will help them. So we have to encourage young people who have caring responsibilities to come forward, and we also have to train the staff who work with young people to learn how to recognise the signals that a young person might be a carer, and then to respond appropriately to the impact those caring duties may be having on their quality of schooling or personal development. I was struck by how isolating being a carer must be for many young people, and how we all can and should do better to change that situation. Then this year, I had the privilege of working with the Carers Trust and Young Adult Carers to launch their Going Higher campaign to extend a similar approach throughout colleges and universities. As I said at the launch of the campaign, it seems perfectly reasonable that educational institutions would adopt a person-centred approach to ensuring that everyone fulfils their potential. And we should do the same as a parliament and as a society. The starting point has to be the situation facing each carer, and from that we put together the right package of support. The bill, as it currently stands, is a good starting point. It aims to provide a framework for recognising and supporting carers. It aims to improve identification of adult carers and young carers. It aims to place a duty on local authorities to support carers. It places a duty on local authorities to develop and publish local carer strategies and make provision for carer involvement. And it places a duty on local authorities to provide information and advice services to all carers. However, many of the briefings I've read argue that the bill does not go far enough and that it does not offer enough detail. Amongst these are concerns with the lack of timescales for the production of adult carer support plans, inconsistencies and potentially a postcode lottery in eligibility criteria for carer support, and levels of finance and choice to be provided for respite short breaks. It's clear that what is needed is a coherent, multi-agency approach for most carers. I don't think anyone disagrees on that need. It's been discussed many times in this Parliament, but I sincerely hope the bill will go further as it progresses to foster such an approach across Scotland. The bill currently focuses excessively on the responsibilities of local authorities and insufficiently on what the NHS and other agencies, including the third sector, can do in addition to and in collaboration with local authorities. As this is stage one of the bill, it's right that it's supported by the Parliament. At future stages of the bill, however, it's essential that the Scottish Government listens closely to the concerns raised by those groups who represent carers, as well as individual carers themselves, in order to ensure that the bill takes a meaningful step towards improving circumstances for carers and those whom they care for. If not, this bill could be another missed opportunity. Thank you.
Thank you very much. I now call Willie Coffey to be followed by Joan McAlpine.
Presiding Officer, thank you. And I feel quite privileged actually to be allowed to speak in the debate today. As usual, I want to start by commending the good work carried out by colleagues on the committee and their comprehensive stage one report on this carers bill. And also to welcome the very detailed and supportive responses by the Minister in his reply to the committee. Please correct me if I'm wrong, but I counted at least six commitments to amend the bill at stage two after some lengthy and heartfelt evidence was offered by the committee to the committee by a number of stakeholders along the way. And a number of commitments were also made to provide additional guidance alongside the bill to deal with many clarifications sought by the committee on behalf of those giving evidence. I'm not a member of the committee, like some other members making a contribution today, so I hope that I do some justice to the work carried out by others. The bill is really about caring for the carers, isn't it? And it sets out where we think help is most needed and where the most positive interventions might take place. I really liked the opening comment in the policy memorandum that the bill is to make real the Scottish Government's ambition for Scotland's adults and young carers to be better supported on a more consistent basis, so that they continue to care in good health and have a life alongside caring. What a lovely way of simplifying the bill down to that description. To have a life alongside caring. Yes?
Joanne Lamont, would you agree that making it real and that we would all aspire to, you have to get the money right too? And do you share the concerns that have been expressed about the potential gap between our aspiration and the funding that's going to underpin it?
Willie Coffey.
Absolutely, of course you do, and I think the issues and debates about finance and resources have been well covered and are covered in the committee report, and I'm pretty sure will be referred to by the Minister in his summing up. As I said, I think it's a lovely way to simplify down the bill to that description, to have a life alongside caring. I think too often overlooked and ignored, and sometimes not even recognised by carers themselves, as has been mentioned by a few members today too. And as I read through the report, it was clear that the bill seems to set out a sort of carer's journey and how we can and should be helping along the way. From recognising the role of our younger carers and the help they need from their schools, right through to the possible end of a carer's responsibilities through choice or circumstances. The bill and the committee seem to recognise the issues of importance that we need to provide for. Presiding Officer, tonight we know that it's Guy Fawkes Night, and thousands of carers across Scotland will either be out there making sure a loved one is enjoying the night at some of the many displays that will take place, and I can recommend the display at Kilmarnock's K Park, which will attract over 30,000 people. Or they will be caring for a loved one at home and possibly missing out themselves. That's why I think I was drawn initially to the committee's comments on providing these short breaks for our carers. So important to provide for this, even for a couple of hours, as the witnesses highlighted. And I note that the Minister has agreed to clarify that definition of what short breaks actually mean in response to the committee's requests. I know that short breaks are not new, but if we can build in a mechanism that formalises them, then it means that carers don't need to feel guilty about taking a break, and those being cared for no longer need to feel guilty either if their carer was previously not able to get one. A recognised short break, simple enough, but very, very important. It helps remove the problem and helps us progress the aim of the bill of supporting a life alongside caring. Looking at our younger carers, I was absolutely staggered to read that the number of young carers in Scotland was thought to be over 40,000, and the suggestion in the committee's report from witnesses that it could even be as high as 100,000. Are those giving evidence asked for more work to be done to identify our young carers, especially those at school, many of whom probably don't recognise that they are even performing the role? Often these young carers only need a little bit of information and advice and a little flexibility when it comes to school timetables and attendance, and that we should do our best to try and identify these young carers before any crises develop. So the schools have a crucial role to play, and this too is acknowledged by the Minister's intention to set this out in guidance in relation to the development of our local carer strategies. I would also be interested to see if any research has been done on the educational attainment of young carers, to see if that might have had any impact, caring had any impact on them, and what proportion of them move on to further and higher education. But that's an issue, I know, for another day. The potential confusion in having the proposed young carers statement and child's plan was raised, but I think the Minister explained that well, and that the carers statement is about identifying specific support needs for the carer and the triggers that are required for intervention, whereas the plan is an overarching summary of this, as I understand it. Where there was a concern, the presiding officer, was in the overlap between a young person's role as a carer and the named person proposals, and the possible unintended intrusion this might cause if a young carer had not consented to any of those interventions. Again, the Minister has recognised this and agreed and will remove this possibility from the bill at stage two. At some point in a young carer's life, they'll reach the age of 18 and begin to make that transition to adulthood themselves and begin to interact with adult services in respect of their caring role. Clearly, many young people may want to move on and cease their caring role in order to progress their own lives. And I simply note the sensitive way this is discussed in the committee's paper and the recognition given to supporting such a process by the Minister in his comments. In conclusion, Presiding Officer, it's been a privilege to be actually able to make a contribution to this important debate and to highlight for the public the many positive steps being taken by the Scottish Government to recognise the invaluable work carried out by Scotland's carers. We do care about their quality of life, to live their own lives in good health, and also to be entitled to a life alongside caring. I commend the work of the committee, the witnesses and the Scottish Government, and look forward to the progress of the bill and becoming law. Thank you.
Many thanks. I now call Joan McAlpine to be followed by Dr Richard Simpson.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. Can I say that I support this bill as a continuation of the considerable progress that has been made in Scotland in recognising and supporting carers in recent years, and I particularly congratulate the Minister for listening to the voices of those in Able in particular who wanted the bill to ensure that emergency planning is discussed as part of the carer planning process. The Minister will recall that I've spoken to him and his team about this on several occasions, so I share Enable's delight in the success of their campaign. My own sister has Down syndrome and is cared for by my elderly mother, and I know from their experience and from the experience of friends and other attendees at my sister's day centre that this is a very real issue, if not the most important issue, that concerns older carers in particular. The very important statistical information published this spring and based on the 2011 census returns showed that the age group
someone is most likely to be a carer is 55 to 64 years old, but it's not unusual, particularly with regards to learning disability, dementia and end-of-life care, that the carer will be in their 70s or their 80s. An example of the difference an emergency plan can make was the case of Jeanette, which was highlighted by Enable in the course of the campaign. Jeanette looked after her daughter Vanessa, who has learning disabilities, and she had no emergency plan in place until she decided to go, and she had to go into hospital for a knee replacement. And sometime after she was discharged, she had an awful experience in that she collapsed at home in the early hours. But because she had this written emergency plan in place, the emergency services were able to consult the plan and contact the right respondent and get the right care in place for Vanessa. And as Jeanette said afterwards, I know people think that they can go on caring, but things happen that change that, and I would urge them to take the time to put a plan in place. And that draws attention to the fact that, you know, Jeanette obviously had that experience and she was supported to do it by her local authority. That good services do happen in Scotland, but we need this bill to ensure that provision becomes consistent right across the country. Can I also welcome moves by the Minister to prioritise plans for those caring for individuals with a terminal illness? And I would just like to put on record that I support the calls from Marie Curie and other members that GPs should be involved in identifying carers in these circumstances. And I'm also very sympathetic to calls that carers' views should be considered when discharge plans are put in place by hospitals. Turning to the bill more generally, I am the co-convener of the cross-party group on carers, and as such, I would draw attention to the briefing from the national carers organisations, and which welcome the bill, of course, but have certain asks in terms of strengthening it. And I think in my role as a co-convener, I'd like to put these asks on record. They are a redefinition of outcomes to acknowledge that carers have a right to a life outside caring. Eligibility criteria, short breaks duty on local authorities, ensuring that replacement care is properly funded, ensuring that support services in the third sector and public sector are prepared for the additional demand placed on them as more carers identify themselves. A duty on the NHS to involve carers in discharge plans, as I've already mentioned. A statutory right of advocacy and a statement on equality. Now, time means that I cannot go into all those in detail, and I'm aware of the cost constraints that means not every single one of them is necessarily going to be delivered. However, if I had to single out one, it would be the request for a nationally defined eligibility criteria. In my experience, there is quite passionate opposition to locally defined eligibility criteria among carers and their representatives, and I would say they're extremely consistent in their demand for consistencies. Indeed, in my opinion, the big three asks in terms of strengthening the bill from carers' organisations were emergency plans, the waiving of charges and a national eligibility criteria. And I welcome the fact that the first two of these big three are being brought forward, addressed by the Minister in his amendments. And I would ask that he doesn't rule out similar measures to address the third. Now, I'm aware that the Health Committee is sympathetic to both local authorities and carers' organisations with regard to eligibility criteria, and it states that in its report. And I note too that the Minister, in his reply to the committee, says that in 2016 and 2017, before the bill is commenced, the Scottish Government will work with COSLA, local authorities, the national carers organisations and carers themselves to share ideas and views about eligibility criteria. However, we have heard examples from various speakers right across the chamber today of the variability of services. Some excellent services, as I've outlined in the care of Jeanette, but also others have mentioned really poor experiences that their constituents have had. So I would say that the bill exists because of a patchiness in approach, and we are legislating to address that patchiness in support. And so you could therefore argue that a nationally defined criteria for eligibility is actually an extension of the general principles that lie behind the bill, and that's why I think it shouldn't be ruled out. Thank you very much.
Thank you. I now call Dr. Richard Simpson to be followed by Richard Lyle.
Deputy Presiding Officer, I'm glad to join others in speaking in this debate, although I'm no longer a member of the Health Committee. But I do find myself once again, though commending the intentions of the bill, questioning the legislation as it's been tabled, because carers don't just deserve warm words, but detailed commitments. And once again, we have a bill without draft regulations, regulations which are critical to the delivery of the bill. In the hustings at the 2011 election, which was attended by carers, I promised then that if carers, Scottish Labour formed the government, I would seek to ensure that our priorities matched those of carers. Labour had already sought to make it possible for carers to seek an assessment of their own health, which is fundamental. And this, of course, shouldn't be a one-off event, but has to be a continuing process. A carer looking after a person with a deteriorating condition, such as dementia, will be likely to face increasing challenges that makes their own health more vulnerable. The support plan helps, but the thresholds and the nature and the extent are unclear. The concerns about a postcode lottery and thresholds is valid, as is the question about the length of time for an assessment to be undertaken, and this is not just about terminal care. For example, as the committee has clearly indicated, respite also is an issue because it can mean many different things, from a period of a week or more to an hour or two a week. There needs to be clarity on thresholds. There need to be minimum standards and levels. And I believe the committee is right to express its concern about provision in relation to terminal illness. This requires priority. One cannot wait when one gets into a terminal situation. One needs action immediately. The agreement to ensure that all carers who wish it will have an emergency plan was one of the most significant asks in 2011 and led me to ask Alex Salmond as First Minister in FMQs as to why this was not occurring. And he gave an undertaking that this would occur, and it's a pity that 3 years on we're still actually just talking about legislation. I can't understand how anyone listening to carers who are growing old and have to look after their adult children with learning disability, as Linda Fabiana referred to, cannot hear the anxiety that they have about what happens if they have an emergency. I've currently got a family experience in dementia care. The social worker and the carer support have both been very helpful. But my relative and the prime carer is uncertain about the recent week's respite care as to whether that will be charged or free. She simply cannot find out. There are other areas of vagueness. There is an absolute need for carers to be advised of discharge from hospital and to be involved in the admission. This is, of course, a requirement where there is a formal incapacity, but it must also be addressed for those with capacity on a consensual basis. A recent Scottish study showed that 50% of patients with a prior diagnosis of dementia before admission do not have this critical fact recorded on their notes. Too often, carers feel excluded by a medicalised process. And as far as discharge is concerned, notification must not just be a general intention, but it must be detailed. Colleagues, never again can we have reports, as we did have in the press, of a blind man being discharged in the middle of the night without even knowing if there are going to be relatives at home. This is unacceptable. The role of GPs in this new integrated world that we all seek remains unclear. Their knowledge and their role is important. Where is the support, for example, for such groups as the Edinburgh North West PMS group that I attended yesterday, where 12 of the 16 practices were able to be there, along with practice managers and various Lothian staff? This group has link workers to undertake detailed assessment as part of post-diagnosis and dementia, an area that general practice has been tasked for. And the quality of the carer and patient experience is measurably improved. Now, this is an example of how a cluster in the new world that the government is now beginning to accept within a new contract could work. And I commend the work of this group to the Minister. We also heard reports from Muirhouse Practice, which has established an effective computer-based signposting and information service for support, both local and national, which can be given to carers. This is not rocket science, but it requires administrative support so that it does not have to be done on an individual practice basis. As Graham Day said, at a time when general practice is under stress, the government have a duty to make their intentions much clearer on requirements, but also on resources. And on finance, I don't believe that even the adjusted financial memorandum bears scrutiny.
The £16 million is not, as I understand it, new money, so what is it? And if we look at dementia, there's a substantial drive for early diagnosis and first-year post-diagnostic support. If this is to be tied to a robust delivery of the aspirations in this bill, we can hope that fewer individuals will require institutional care, which will ameliorate some of the growing pressures on the NHS. Deputy Presiding Officer, as in almost every intervention I make in this Parliament on matters of health and social care, I call for there to be robust monitoring of the process, but also of the outcomes. Who will undertake this role? Is it the Care Inspectorate? What work has been done already on the elements that should be reported? Carers should not have to revert to their MSPs when their needs are unmet, so the right for advocacy is an important part of ensuring that issues can be early resolved. But I feel I have to repeat again that the landscape on comments, concerns and interventions from individuals where they have problems is incredibly cluttered, and there is a vital need to align the Patient Rights Act feedback section to the social care system. If this is not done, we will not achieve the ability for carers to contest the matters which are placed in front of them, or their assessment, or the timing, or all the other issues which have been quite rightly brought up by colleagues. Deputy Presiding Officer, in conclusion, the general principles of this bill are welcome. The aspirations of the government are, as always, welcome. But if these aspirations are to be met, the detail, the draft regulations on many aspects, the system of monitoring, the financing, all must be much clearer before this Parliament passes this bill at stage three.
Many thanks. I have a few minutes left in hand, so Mr Lyle, I can give you up to 7 minutes, and then I can have one extra minute each for the closing speakers. Richard Lyle.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. It's always a pleasure to follow Dr Richard Simpson and respond to his comments. And I would like to start off by saying that I believe that the SNP government has a strong record in supporting health in Scotland. And I'm sure it will continue to do everything in its power to make sure that the people of Scotland have access to the best health care available and work to ensure that no group of people are overlooked when it comes to health. As we adapt to an ageing population, the role of carers will become even more important. So there is an overwhelming economic, social and moral case for continuing to improve services offered to carers. The Carers Bill will, for the first time in Scotland, enshrine the rights of carers in law. It proposes a range of measures to improve and expand support for carers. I think, therefore, Presiding Officer, it is important to hear some of the key facts and stories about our carers in Scotland today. Currently, as has already been said, there are an estimated 745,000 adult carers and around 44,000 young carers in Scotland. The value of the care that they provided is estimated to be around £10.3 billion each year. What tends to go overlooked is that caring can have a detrimental impact on the health and well-being of a carer, which can subsequently affect the quality of care that the person who is being cared for receives. Caring can intensify pre-existing health problems in carers or even lead to new health problems. It is estimated that around 32% of carers have indicated that caring has a negative impact on their health, and research has shown that most common health effects are psychological. It is not morally acceptable to allow someone who is providing care to another human being to suffer on their own. That's why in the First Minister's programme for government, I noted that the government has placed this issue at the forefront and have invested around £114 million in programmes to support carers more than ever before. And it's also why we need to address this issue in the here and now. Recently, I heard a story about a man named Ronnie who cared for his wife for the past 15 years. His wife needed 24-hour care, and so Ronnie gave up his job 12 years ago to be able to look after her full time. When asked what we could do to help him, Ronnie replied, "There's not enough recognition of what a carer does." Where have we heard that before? When he filled in the forms, there was no category for full-time carer. No one understands that, what that is. Stories like Ronnie's are why the Scottish Government should place and will place the needs of carers at the heart of the devolved carers allowance. Presiding officer, carers sacrifice so much for the betterment of others, and now it is them who are suffering. We can't sit on the sidelines and let these carers suffer any longer. This bill we are debating today aims to improve and provide greater support to carers. At the present time, the law sees a carer as someone who provides or intends to provide a substantial amount of care on a regular basis to a person aged 18 or over, who is a person for whom the local authority provides community care services. This bill will broaden the definition of what a carer is to encompass more and more people who go unrecognised as carers to get the recognition that they deserve. To accomplish this goal, the bill will remove the requirement for care to be substantial and regular. This bill will give local authorities a duty to prepare a support plan for anyone who identifies as a carer or any carer who requests one. This support is something that many carers drastically need, and it's our job to ensure they receive it. When it comes to young carers who are a shining beacon of the incredible young people that we have here in Scotland. Young carers are those under the age of 18 or are 18 and still at school. It is the government's responsibility to make sure that they are looked after. It is my firm belief that we must do everything in our power to protect the well-being of young carers. Under the current legislation, if the young carer's needs can be addressed through the normal courses of things like parents or mainstream services, then there is no need for a support plan. This is unacceptable, and I am pleased to say that this new bill addresses this issue. Under one of the proposals, the bill will give a responsible authority a duty to prepare a young carer statement for anyone who believes to be a young carer and for any young carer who requests one. This will improve access to support for young carers and hopefully prevent the escalation of caring needs. As I am nearing the end of my reflections on carers in Scotland, Presiding Officer, I want to highlight one more story that I read about from the Carers Trust. I also recommend that all of my colleagues, if they have not already done so, take the time to read and learn more of the touching stories about carers throughout the UK. This particular story is about a 14-year-old girl who is caring for her 8-year-old brother, who suffers from a very rare genetic condition. This girl lives with her mum and her brother, so it can be hard for her mum to get all the jobs done round about the house. This girl can no longer live a normal childhood. It was not her choice to live this life, but is the life she lives. She talks about how, when she talks to people like doctors and social workers, some of them don't listen to her because of her age. Presiding Officer, I am here today. Members across the chamber are here today. And we're all saying to this young girl that this Scottish Parliament is here today and we are listening to you. I want to conclude, Presiding Officer, by highlighting once again that some of the key points of this bill. The Carers Bill will enshrine carers' rights in law for the first time in Scotland. The bill will ensure that carers will be protected from being charged for the support they receive. And the Scottish Government will seek to amend the Carers Bill to enshrine emergency planning in the care plan process. This Government is committed, I am sure, to ensuring that we look after our carers. And even with all the comments that have been made by other members today, let's appreciate their tireless efforts. Let's appreciate carers in all aspects. They are true heroes, and I commend all of them for all the work that they do each and every day. Thank you, Presiding Officer.
Many thanks. We now turn to closing speeches, and I call on Jackson Carlaw. Up to 7 minutes, please, Mr. Carlaw.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. Can I say at the outset that this has been a very interesting and well-informed debate this afternoon? It's been one in which I think all of the pertinent questions have been made in some very well-targeted and indeed passionate speeches during the course of the afternoon. There have been quite a lot of calls for change. Often in this chamber, that presages a partisan debate that's going to follow. But I don't get any sense of that at all. It seems to me that the Minister himself recognises that this is an important bill which is a work in progress. And from the contributions that came from members around the chamber, a bill which I hope the Minister will be open beyond the amendments he's already identified to considering and incorporating some of the additional amendments that I think cases for which were made powerfully this afternoon. It's interesting that we meet and debate this afternoon, the same day as the BMA have published their manifesto for Scotland, because right at the start of that, they talk about the challenge of population. And I think this actually underpinned one of the key points Jackie Bailey made in terms of what are we setting in train now and will we have the resource to fund it as the population continues to change? Because it's clear from the demographic, I think all of us who debate these matters in health regularly know that the profile of the population in Scotland has changed dramatically. 100 years ago, it's clear it was a young country. It's hard to imagine that actually older people were there by exception, not the rule. But as we look now, we see the enormous increase in the number of elderly. As Jim Hume said, something that we can celebrate, but nonetheless, it brings with it challenges for the future. And as we look forward, an even greater concentration. And we've talked before about how we've moved from the experience of care being provided within a family being an exception to being something of which we nearly all now have first-hand experience of. And it is going to become more common, not less so, as we go forward. And therefore, I thought the point Joanne Lamont made, and I think it was in saying that a right which is unenforceable is unacceptable, was very powerful, because we have embarked upon huge and important social legislation in this chamber before, whether it's free transport for the elderly, whether it's free personal care for the elderly, which we are funding, but at a rate which is far greater than anybody had envisaged when we began. And therefore, when we commence these important changes for carers, it's important that we know that we are putting in place the mechanism by which that can be properly and effectively realised, not just now, but as we go forward as well. I thought Duncan McNeill, the Minister, in identifying the various amendments, gave quite a technical speech, and Duncan McNeill brought it very much back to the very personal role of carers. In fact, Richard Lyle, I think, ended the debate in exactly the same way. And I thought the points he made in terms of the end-of-life carer assessment, the priority that needed to be attached potentially to that, albeit I accepted Richard Simpson's more general point as well, the emergency planning arrangements, the welcome he gave that additional services would not be required unless they were absolutely needed, and the focus he brought on discharge and admissions, which Richard Simpson gave a stark example of in his contribution to, do remain areas where there is considerable work still to be done. I very much appreciated the contribution of Rhoda Grant, particularly in the area of post-carer support, because I think the reality is that while we say that with younger carers that we want to ensure that their opportunities aren't in any way compromised by the role they take on as carers, which they feel they have to, and I have an experience of this in my own family, the reality is they are. They are. You simply can't have a young person who is maybe coming out of education, going into further education, who is suddenly brought in to the domestic situation to care on a very concentrated basis for a relative, and for that not to have an impact on the potential opportunities they will have when they become post-carer individuals. And I think it's very important that we do try to find a way of building into our thinking the way in which we give post-carer support to individuals in order that they are able to resume their lives and to make full use and to exploit all the potential opportunity that they have, which may have been set to one side at the time. And it's not just good enough to say it. The reality is it is happening, and we have to meet that. I thought Graham Day was interesting when he brought up the example of GP practices identifying potential carers. I know my colleague Margaret Mitchell wanted me to highlight the practice in one Motherwell GP where they now have an automatic flagging of carers so that any GP, if a carer presents, is stimulated to ask to check particularly how their own health is. I've already mentioned Joanne Lamont's thoughtful speech, which I thought some very well-focused questions, but I particularly felt that she raised an important point in the bureaucracy that underpins the opportunity for people to get minor respite and the desire that there should be to try and offer that on a much more ready basis. Linda Famiani introduced the issue, it was something of a digression, but nonetheless an important one, of early onset dementia. This is something that the Petitions Committee have been dealing with over some considerable period of time. And more recently, the Cabinet Secretary did say that she was now looking at proposals which she hopes to bring before Parliament in the new year. And I know we look forward to hearing what those will be. But Jackie Bailey, and my goodness, Jackie has certainly carried a load for the Labour Party this week. The voice of reason on Tuesday, a partisan turn in good old tribal way yesterday. But today, those very forensic skills in a whole series of issues relating to finance, which I hope the Minister will respond to. Mr Coffey said he was very confident he would, and he must, like me, have seen the blizzard of communication coming from the clerks down to Mr Hepburn following Ms Bailey's speech, so I am very confident that we are going to get those financial questions answered. Presiding Officer, we have, I think, got across the chamber a bill for which there is a tremendous amount of goodwill. There are concerns expressed that have to be addressed. I'm confident they probably will be too. But it's important that as this bill leaves Parliament and becomes a legal entitlement, that the financial underpinning of it is robust and is looking to the future as well as today. Otherwise, we will be looked upon as people who had rather a rose-tinted spectacle of how these things would operate and did not put in place the provision that would ensure that they were effective as well.
Many thanks. I now call on Neil Findlay. Up to 9 minutes, please.
Presiding Officer, caring is something we all do. Even cold, stone-hearted politicians, I think, have got some care within us. At least I hope so when I look around the chamber. And we do that, whether that's for our children, our friends, our grandparents, neighbours, and our mums and dads, and we all show that love and affection and perform our duty as hopefully members of a civilised society through our friendship, our compassion and care for those who need our help. We see it in our communities and around us every day and every week. And that care can be expressed in so many different ways. It's maybe just a simple thing like dropping in occasionally to check that your neighbour is okay, or driving a parent to a day centre or a pensioners group, providing a daily meal or taking a friend to hospital or doctor's appointments. These are acts of care that we all do and that we see regularly. But for many people, many of our family and friends and neighbours, caring as a commitment requires much more than that. It requires a dedication that is often full-time, and Duncan McNeill eloquently described the consequences of such a level of commitment for those people who perform that role. And several speakers mentioned the numbers of carers involved. It is quite an astronomical figure, almost 800,000 Scots providing that caring role. And I was very pleased that Joanne Lamont mentioned young carers. That point that I raised about that young girl in my class at school will live with me for some time, because she was clearly a young girl who lacked confidence, was pretty anonymous in the class. She sunk into the background and she didn't say very much. And no wonder she never said very much, because what she was doing at home was taking up all her efforts and all her energy. The fact that I didn't know that as her teacher, I think, was shameful, and that showed a breakdown in the system that should have alerted me or any other teacher who went into that class, whether it be for one day or whether it was for the rest of the year. But these people don't need or, I believe, don't want our sympathy or our warm words. What they need and want is our support in both deed and in budget. And it's estimated, as many people have said, there's a huge financial value, billions, up to 10 billion, a remarkable figure, on the amount of care that's provided. So we need to invest to ensure people get a fair deal for all of that, and they get the support that they deserve and the people they care for deserve. And all that, of course, comes at a cost to carers themselves. As Jim Hume mentioned, the effect on people's psychological well-being and being in problems of mental ill health, anxiety, lack of confidence and self-esteem. Carers are also more likely to be in debt, more likely to have to leave their job, have reduced hours, all of that because of the pressures of having to juggle a job and caring responsibilities. And all of that has a huge strain on their emotional well-being, but also their personal relationships. And for these and many other reasons, they require our help and support, and the help and support of the communities that they live in. So, Presiding Officer, given that vital role that they play, in our community, any bill to help carers, I think, would be welcomed. However, I think during the today there has been some serious questions that must be answered about the substance of the bill and how it will actually help and improve the daily realities faced by carers. And as Richard Simpson said, there is a real concern about the lack of regulations that accompany this. Jackie Bailey mentioned many of those points that the Minister and his team will have to answer. Of course, everyone will support the proposal for carers' plans. It's hardly controversial. Ensuring that there is a support plan that identifies the needs of carers is a good thing. On the passage of the bill, we would like to see this provision implemented without delay, but the support plan and young carers' statement in themselves will only be worth the paper they are written on if they're followed through with support put in place and fully financed so that the plan becomes a reality. You can write up as many plans as you like and you can stick them in a cupboard, but if it doesn't mean anything for the people who need our assistance, then it's hardly been worth the effort. Issues around the eligibility criteria, whether that's at a national level or a local level, will be debated through during the process of the bill. And some suggest national criteria, others suggest local criteria. Whatever it is, it has to be effective and it has to allow flexibility to meet local needs whilst ensuring that people can get equal access. And we agree that plans that incorporate education and training, certainly.
Bob Doris.
What's been a very thoughtful speech just in terms of national and local eligibility criteria. I'd said that there was a confusion some amongst different people within the carer sector and what they meant by that. When you talk about equal access, I wonder if you're talking about equal access to trigger for where care support needs must be met by a local authority, or whether you meant equality and provision, because they're two very different things, obviously, and equality of provision doesn't necessarily allow that local discretion.
Neil Finlay.
I think for the people on the ground, they want to ensure that they've got equal access to what they actually receive because that ultimately that's what they want. They want an improved service, the service they receive. Now, whether that's better done nationally or locally, we can debate that through, but ultimately it's about what ends up happening in those people's lives that's most important. I'm also very positive about the role of advocacy and counselling. Income maximisation is a huge issue, and these are all very relevant to the lives of people who are carers, but much of that should be being provided already. But of course, it can't be, because things like this cost money and you cannot provide such services on fresh air and crossed fingers in a steeply declining budget and local government. The main concerns are about the financial provisions in the bill, and Rhoda Grant, Joanne Lamont, Jackie Bailey and others raised this. These new provisions will place additional duties and responsibilities on councils, and assessments just in themselves will cost money and need to be fully funded. But it's the additional consequences of any assessment that will add those additional funding pressures on councils who are already at breaking point. Councils are not at the bone. They're well through the marrow and almost at the other end. The social care system, social work departments, social workers, support workers are drowning under intense pressure, whilst year-on-year budget cuts threaten the very services that civilise us as a society. And there is good practice going on, and Jackson Carlow, who mentioned some of the good practice in Motherwell. That's all very welcome, but that's despite the system, at times not because of it. My own local authority in West Lothian has lost £89 million taken from it in the last 6 or 7 years. It only has a budget of £400 million and it's lost £89. So how, without fully funded support for this bill and funding to replace what we've already lost, can we provide the services that carers and the cared for and the families need? Councils across Scotland are staring at more job losses, more service cuts. So the Scottish Government has to get real about the crisis in local government finance and stop pretending that it will somehow go away and we can give councils more responsibility whilst we've already given them less money.
Must come to a close, please.
Okay. One vital area, Presiding Officer, people have mentioned is on in relation to breaks. And again, as the bill goes through, that debate will go on. Finally, Presiding Officer, I want to put on record my support for my local carers organisation, Carers of West Lothian. People have all mentioned theirs. They've just moved into their new premises and they help thousands of carers across the county. We will, of course, support this bill, but as it goes through its parliamentary process, it has to be strengthened and the financial issues must be resolved. As Joanne Lamont said, a right is not a right if it's not enforceable. I wholeheartedly agree with that.
Thank you. Now calling Jamie Hepburn to respond to the debate. Minister, you have until 5 o'clock.
Thank you very much, President Officer. Can I thank all members for their contribution? I think this has been a very thoughtful debate. I very much agree with Jackson Carlow. I think this has been a very good debate, although I'll try and be a little less technical in my summation than I was in my opening remarks, even in the 10 minutes or so that are available to me. I'm unlikely to be able to respond to every point, so I apologise for that in advance. I'll try to respond to as many as I can. But let me say at the outset, President Officer, this Government's vision is for a flourishing, optimistic and innovative Scotland, and tackling inequalities and promoting equality of opportunity remain our major challenges. We want a Scotland where people have control of their lives and are empowered to make choices, and Scotland's carers have to be involved in that. I'm sure that's a common aspiration for us all. Duncan McNeill, in his thoughtful opening remarks, made the point, as did I, albeit in different words, that caring can be life-affirming, but it can also have a negative impact on some carers. Whatever the circumstances, carers should enjoy the same opportunities in life as people without caring responsibilities and should be able to achieve their full potential as citizens. Linda Fabiani gave the example that people who are carers might need to be supported to stay in employment, for example. The bill should work to better support carers maintaining a life alongside caring. Rhoda Grant spoke of the needs of individual carers always being different from another. I very much agree. That's why our approach here has to be person-centred. Rhoda Grant also made the fundamentally important point that carers must have the choice to care. I agree with that point as well. That's why in any adult carer support plan, a young carer statement, as well as identifying a carer's personal outcomes and identified needs, information about the extent to which the carer is willing and able to provide care should be in there as well. So we have introduced the Carer Scotland Bill because we want to accelerate the pace of change in building what has already been achieved. As I mentioned in my opening contribution, the Carers Bill introduced a number of provisions aimed at achieving the vision of supporting carers having a life alongside caring by extending their rights in law.
Joanne Lamont. Could I have Ms Lamont's microphone, please? Thank you.
Specifically on the point about carers having to have a life or being entitled to a life out with their caring role, and the point I made about people falling out of work because of lack of flexibility, can I ask what discussions you've had with the Cabinet Secretary for Fair Work Skills about the role of the Fair Work Convention and whether there'll be an input on the needs of carers being recognised in any discussion about what work should look like and how people can be supported?
Minister?
No doubt that convention will absolutely consider the role of carers. I'm happy to explore that matter further with ministerial colleagues, but I suppose the point I'm making here is that each carer is an individual human being, and the assessment should be very much focused on their individual circumstances, and if support to maintain employment is one of those assessed needs, that it should be contained within their assessment. I welcome the widespread support expressed today, I think universal, for the bill. A number of members have suggested need to change the bill to improve it. I would reflect on the fact in my time in this parliament, I can't remember a single bill that has
ended up the same as it was when it was introduced. I've already committed to some changes. I've hopefully demonstrated my willingness to continue to consider and accommodate further changes. Jackson Carlow picks up my demeanour very correctly. I am open to listening to any amendments suggested, and if I agree with them and I think they're effective, I will support them. Sandra White picked up on the issue of care involvement and local carer strategies. Care involvement is throughout this bill. There is a specific duty to take steps to involve carers when preparing and reviewing any local carer strategy. There's also in regulations under the Public Bodies Act. This is an absolute fundamental point. Some members mentioned a concern about the impact of an increase in demand. I recognise there are concerns about the increase in demand associated with the widening of the definition of carer. Joanne Lambton and Nanette Milne picked up on this. However, the increase in demand will be accompanied by a more streamlined assessment process to develop the Adult Carer Support Plan and Young Carer Statement, and additional resources for local authorities will accompany the bill. Rhoda Grant asked if there could be a role for the third sector carer centres in particular to be involved in the assessment process. I should say there's nothing in the bill to prevent that approach, and we want to see innovation in this area. Duncan McNeill and others raised issues about local eligibility criteria. I should reassert we will ensure that local eligibility criteria is informed by regulations. There will be national matters that have to steer that local eligibility criteria, and I'll work with carers' organisations to that end in relation to informing those regulations. Duncan McNeill said if we continue with the approach as we have set out in the bill, the assessment of the efficacy of the approach will be important. Indeed, I think Neil Findlay made the important point. What's key here, what the key issue is here, is that the approach has to be effective. As I set out in my response to the Health and Sport Committee, the arrangements for monitoring and assessing implementation of the bill's provisions, including support provided to carers under local eligibility criteria, will be agreed with COSLA, individual local authorities, the national carers' organisations and other key interests. Linda Fabiani and Richard Simpson raised the issue of emergency planning and future planning. I agree that emergency and future planning is very important to carers. That's why I'm bringing forward an amendment at stage two, so that information about emergency planning must be contained within the Adult Care Support Plan or the Young Carers Statement. I also recognise the importance of future planning, particularly for older carers, and Sandra White spoke about the needs of older carers as important to her contribution today. I intend to bring forward an amendment so that the Information Advice Service must provide information about future planning as well as emergency planning. As we move forward, how the information is shared with general practitioners, the point made by Richard Simpson, is something I will carefully consider as well. Joanne Lamont raised issues around kinship carers. I should say the provisions of this bill will apply to kinship carers. Bob Doris made the point about the funding that has been agreed and with COSLA and is in place to support parity between kinship and foster carer allowances. Duncan McNeill, Sandra White and Rhoda Grant raised issues about short breaks. I can certainly assure Duncan McNeill the process for consultation and scrutiny of the regulations we put in place will be as important to me as they will to him. I want us to get this right. Rhoda Grant asks what can constitute a short break. Again, we need to be flexible here, Presiding Officer. I think short breaks can constitute a great many things. They can be different things to different people, and I agree with the point that the committee made in their report that guidance regarding the provision of short breaks should make clear the importance of ensuring that short breaks are tailored to the needs of the individual carer. Graeme Day and Annette Milne raised the issue of the transition from the caring role when it ends. I know this is an issue of importance to Marie Curie. I recognise it can be difficult, even devastating for an individual when their caring role comes to an end. The bill deliberately focuses on providing access to an adult carer support plan or young carer statement in order to sustain the caring role. But I am, of course, aware that some local carer centres continue to support carers after the caring role ends, and both Graeme Day and Joanne Lamont spoke of the good work in their areas in that regard. Now, I'd be very happy to explore and guidance how good practice in this can be shared. Graeme Day, Jim Hume and Annette Milne raised the issue of the limit on timescales for an adult carer support plan, a young carer statement, and issues around why there's no national limit. I agree it's important for carers to have an indication of how long it may take to prepare an adult carer support plan, a young carer statement. That's why I have made provision requiring each local authority to set out their intended timescales for preparing such as part of their local carer strategy. I hear it calls that we should look at this further still. I'm very happy to consider anything that is brought forward at a subsequent stage, of course.
Jackie Bailey. I'm conscious that time is running out and there were some substantial financial questions that carers' organisations wanted answered.
Hopefully I've answered some of those substantive issues, but I'm also conscious of time, Ms Bailey, and I'll try and get on with it as quickly as I can. Of course, we have moved in relation to the timescales for preparing plans for those who are caring for the terminally ill. We've set that out in response to the Stage 1 report. I will not have time to respond to the issues about the named person and discharge, but I'm happy to respond further at another time. Let me say on the financial issues, because I think that is what Ms Bailey was driving at. Let me be clear. The estimates presented in the financial memorandum with this bill were informed by comprehensive information provided from local authorities. To date, taking into account the work of the finance group I have established, there is no further evidence to suggest that the financial memorandum represents anything other than a robust assessment of the likely cost of this bill's provisions, and we will, by the year 2021-22, be providing £88 million, including £63 million for direct support to carers. That is a substantial commitment to carers across Scotland, Presiding Officer, as is this bill, and I commend it to Parliament.
Thank you. That concludes the debate on the Carer Scotland Bill. The next item of business is consideration of motion number 12890 in the name of John Swinney and the financial resolution for the Carer Scotland Bill. I call on Jamie Hepburn to move the motion.
It moved.
Question. This motion will be put at decision time. The next item of business is consideration of two Parliamentary Bureau motions. I would ask Joe Fitzpatrick to move motion number 14731 on committee membership and motion number 14732 on substitution on committees.
Moved.
Thank you. The question on these motions will be put at decision time too. There are four questions to be put as a result of today's business. The first question is that motion number 14702 in the name of Jamie Hepburn on the Carer Scotland Bill be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
The motion is therefore agreed to. The next question is that motion number 12890 in the name of John Swinney on the financial resolution for the Carer Scotland Bill be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
The motion is therefore agreed to. The next question is that motion number 14731 in the name of Joe Fitzpatrick on committee membership be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
The motion is therefore agreed to. The next question is that motion number 14732 in the name of Joe Fitzpatrick on substitution on committees be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
The motion is therefore agreed to. That concludes decision time and I close this meeting.